And we're about to begin the second turn of our 1861 scenario, and I will be incorporating an optional rule from the unofficial third edition of the rules of this game. As you know, armies have a reaction radius comprising the hex they're in and the six surrounding hexes. The optional rule gives a limited radius of reaction to forces comprising only the hex that they occupy, and I think this rule is reasonable, because otherwise forces are sitting ducks in the path of an advancing army. So we begin turn number two, autumn, September, October 1861, and we go to the reinforcement phase. And the Union receives 8 strength points in the east, 8 in the west, 1 in the Trans-Mississippi, and 1 discretionary strength point. And we mark the reinforcement levels on the reinforcement track. On the Confederate side, there will be a rail capacity of 4 strength points this turn, 7 strength points of reinforcements in the east, 7 in the west, none in the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 discretionary strength points. We will mark the rail capacity using this black die, which we will keep off the map. And we now set the reinforcement levels for the Confederates. On the Union side, we also note that they will have a sea lift capacity of 6 strength points in this turn. And we place the sea lift marker in the number 6 box. And the Union also receives 1 river transport, which we will place in the naval pool. Now we proceed to the command phase, and let's take a look at the resource allocation of the North. These are priority markers that were placed face down at the end of the command phase of the last turn. And the North's primary theater will be the West in this turn, the secondary will be the East, and the tertiary will be the Trans-Mississippi. Now, because we're using the solitaire rules, we roll 1d6 to determine what the Confederate resource allocation will be for this turn. And the roll is a 2, so it will be West primary, East secondary, and Trans-Mississippi tertiary. And now let's place the corresponding number of command points per theater. To do that, we roll on the command points table. Let's roll for the Union first, 2d6. We roll 2 dice, and the result is a 9. So the Union will have 5 commands in the west, 3 in the east, 2 in the Trans-Mississippi, 2 discretionary, and 2 naval commands. And we mark the commands on the Union command track. Now we roll 2d6 for the Confederate command levels, and the roll is a 10. So it will be 4 in the west, 3 in the east, 2 in the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 discretionary command points. And here we have the Confederate command levels. Now we determine the Union command levels for the next turn. Primary will be the east, secondary the west, and tertiary the Trans-Mississippi, and we flip them to their back sides. And the Confederate command levels for the next turn will be rolled for in the next turn, of course. Now to the Commerce Raider phase, but there are no Commerce Raiders available, so we skip this phase. Now to the Blockade Effects phase, and we count the number of victory points cities value in the Confederacy, and that gives us a total of 40. So we placed this arrow here, and we cross-reference it with the blockade percentage, which is 10%. So that means that 36 points of imports make it into the Confederacy. So we add 36 to our production level for the Confederacy, which is 100, so it would be 136. So now you see how the imports start to decrease from 140 in the previous turn to 136. But no ill effects will commence until the import marker is below the 100 mark. And now we add the leaders that are available this turn. We have 3 unnamed leaders and 2 promotions for Jackson and AP Hill, and we place them here in the Confederate leader pool. The Union receives 10 leaders, of which 3 are promotions, and we place those leaders here in the Union leader pool. So now we start the action phase, and we roll 2 dice for each of the sides to see who wins or has the initiative for the pulse. We roll for the Union, an 8, and the Union won, I think, almost all of the pulses the other time. And the Confederates this time roll an 11. And the Confederates have the initiative with a dice difference of 3, so they enter a free leader or strength point at this time. And the Confederates will enter a reinforcement in the west. And the reinforcement will enter here in Memphis. The rebels have 3 strength points. And now they have 4, and there's a 1-star and also a 2-star Confederate leader there under a fortification. And here we see the situation near Washington. The Army of Northern Virginia has 4 strength points. The Army of the Potomac has 5, but there's a strength point also occupying the same hex. So the Army of the Potomac can incorporate that strength point during their next impulse. So the Army of Northern Virginia will not attack at this time. Instead, the Confederates spend all 3 points of dice difference and 3 points of Eastern reinforcements to increase the strength of the Army of Northern Virginia. And the Army's strength is now increased to 7 strength points. Now the Union has to spend its dice difference. It will spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Eastern reinforcement strength points to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac. And we'll also incorporate that strength point that is in the same hex as the Army. So the Army of the Potomac strength increases 2 points for the reinforcements plus the strength point that was in the hex. And now it is 8 strength points strong. And the Union spends its last point of dice difference and 1 Eastern command point to activate this strength point here in West Virginia, which is currently occupying Parkersburg. And it will move 2 hexes here to Charleston. And with Charleston in Union control, the Union receives 2 victory points, which we mark here, and the Union score increases to 10. And if things stay as they are at the end of this turn, the Union will gain extra victory points equal to the total victory point value of all the victory point cities in West Virginia for control of that state. So we roll for another pulse now. We roll for the Union. And, that's bad. That's a 3. So this can be a significant pulse here now. Confederates roll a 6. So the difference is 3. And the Confederates have a dice difference of 3. Now we enter a free reinforcement. The Confederates will enter a reinforcement from the east, and it will be placed in the rebel capital of Richmond. There are 3 strength points there, and now there are 4 with a 3-star leader. Confederates spend 1 point of dice difference, and the rebels will spend 1 command point from the Trans-Mississippi Theater for the purpose of moving this unit here, which is in the mountains, here to Springfield to reinforce AP Hill. But now Hill has 2 strength points there. And as we can see, the Union has a 3-star general and 4 strength points here in Rolla, Missouri. Now the Confederates spend their 2 remaining points of dice difference and 2 west theater command points for the purpose of creating the Army of Tennessee. And it will be placed in Nashville. There are currently 3 strength points there and a 3-star general. So we place the marker for the Army of the Tennessee to reflect a strength of 3. And the Union spends a point of dice difference and an Eastern command point to activate this strength point that recently captured the town of Charleston in West Virginia, and it will move into this hex here to join with the Union forces, which are under the command of a 3-star general. And now our 3 strength points strong, facing 1 Confederate strength point guarding the entrance to the Shenandoah Valley from the west. And the Union will spend its 2 remaining points of dice difference and 1 point of Eastern reinforcements to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac, which now has a strength of 9. So now we go to a new round and we roll for the Union 3. And the Confederates 8. So the difference is 5. So the Confederates have a dice difference of 5, and now we enter a free reinforcement. And the Confederates will enter a East Theater reinforcement, and it will be placed here in Staunton, Virginia, in the Shenandoah Valley, to see if they can reinforce the rebels holding the mountain passes. The situation here in the Eastern Theater: the Army of Northern Virginia is currently 7 strength points strong. The Army of the Potomac is 9, but it is behind a major river. The Army of the Potomac is here. This is a navigable river, and this hex side here is an unnavigable river. So the rebels have a chance of dealing a heavy blow to the Yankees, and they will attempt to do so right now. And they spend 2 points of dice difference and their 2 remaining Eastern reinforcement points to increase the strength of the Army of Northern Virginia to 9, which is equal to that of the Army of the Potomac. And they spend their last 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern theater command points to activate the Army of Northern Virginia. It announces that it will enter the Army of the Potomac's hex, and that is a hex in the Army of the Potomac's reaction radius. The Army of the Potomac is commanded right now by an unnamed 3-star general. That causes us to have to reveal who that 3-star general is. So we select a general from the 3-star cup, and it is, Nathaniel Banks, who's pretty awful. And Banks provides the Confederates with 2 reroll options as commander of the Army of the Potomac. So now the Confederates are attempting to enter that hex. And Banks will attempt to avoid combat. He has to roll higher than 3, so we roll 1d6. But the roll is a 1, so the Army of the Potomac fails to react. And we have ourselves a battle. So here we have the situation: 9 Confederate strength points attacking 9 Union strength points. So the column that we use is the E or 0 differential column. There's no shift for defenders' terrain, nor the attackers crossed any form of river. Now we have to reveal certain leaders that are still unknown, 1 on the Union side and 3 on the Confederate side. And the 3-star unrevealed leader is George McClellan, but he has a tactical rating of 0, so he won't be adding anything to this battle. On the Confederate side, we have to reveal 3 leaders: 1 1-star cavalry and 2 1-star infantry leaders. And the leaders are the cavalry leader, Jeb Stuart. He adds a +1 for his tactical rating. And the regular leaders are, have here John Breckinridge, also a plus one, and Jubal Early, another plus one. So after revealing the leaders, we see that the Union only has a plus one tactical die-roll modifier for Hooker. Meanwhile, the Confederates have a plus five, and worse yet, the Confederates have two reroll options courtesy of Nathaniel Banks. So we roll 1d6 for the Confederates. The result is a 6 modified to an 11, and the Union force suffers a demoralization and 2 strength point loss. Now we roll 1d6 for the Union. The result is a 3 modified to a 4, and they cause a loss of 1 strength point and demoralization on the rebel force. And the rebels have 2 reroll options. They would need a 1 to change the Union attack and result against them to only a 1 point loss. If they roll a 6, their loss would increase to D2. So there's a 1 in 6 chance of a better, less lethal result for the South, but a 1 in 6 chance for a worse result. So they will use a reroll option to reroll the Union result. We roll 1d6. The result is a 3 modified to a 4. Again, demoralization and 1 point of loss. They would have 1 reroll option, but they will not take the chance because if they get a bad result, they won't have a chance to change it again. So that will be the end of the battle. This battle is won by the Confederates by causing more losses on the Union side. Both sides are demoralized. And after the battle has cleared off, the Army of the Potomac has 7 strength points and the Army of Northern Virginia 8. Now we will roll off camera for leader loss. If there is any leader loss, we will show you the results. After checking for leader loss, only Jeb Stuart had an adverse result. He is wounded, so we take him out and we place him with the leaders that are scheduled to enter the game in the next turn, turn number 3. Of the leaders eligible for promotion, Steele and Hooker's next step, counter, is already in the Union leader pool, as well as Jackson's. Breckinridge is not eligible for a promotion, and Early, we place Early's promotion counter now in the turn track, and he is eligible to be promoted in the next turn, turn number 3. So the Army of the Potomac has only one retreat option, and it is north across the navigable River Hexite, and both armies are demoralized. Now it's the Union's turn to spend 5 points of dice difference. And as we see here, the situation with command points, the Union doesn't have enough command points to rally the Army of the Potomac. That would cost 3. And then launch an attack on the demoralized Army of Northern Virginia. The Union only has 1 eastern command point and 2 discretionaries. That's enough only to rally the Army of the Potomac. And the situation with the Confederate command points, the Confederates only have 2 discretionary command points that could be spent in the east because their eastern command points are at 0. So they don't have enough even to rally the Army of Northern Virginia. With the situation in the east at a standstill and both armies demoralized and no prospect of any offensive action by the Confederates there, the Union will spend 3 points of dice difference to spend 2 Trans-Mississippi command points and a discretionary command point for the purpose of activating this unnamed 3-star leader, which is currently here in Drolla, Missouri. And he will move 4 hexes here to Springfield, where A.P. Hill has 2 rebel strength points, and this Union force has 4. And we're using that optional radius reaction rule for forces. So A.P. Hill can try to react, but by doing so, he would be abandoning Springfield, and the Union would capture that state. That's the only Victory Point city left to be controlled by the Union. So AP Hill will fight it out with the Yankees at Springfield. So first we start by revealing who that three-star Union leader is. And the Union leader is Don Carlos Buell, another one of those less-than-stellar Union leaders. So he will be commanding the Union force. And the Union has 4 combat factors. The Rebels have 2. So this is a 2-to-1 attack. Buell has a tactical rating of 1, so he gives 1 plus 1 die roll modifier to the Confederates, have already 2. So the Confederates will have a die roll modifier of 3. We roll first for the Union, 1d6. The Union force is a medium force, so it causes a result of d2 on the Confederates, and that would wipe them out. We now roll for the Confederates, 1d6. The Confederate is a small force, and it only causes a demoralization result, so this battle is won clearly by the Union. The Union eliminate both Confederate strength points. There was no leader loss, but A.P. Hill's force was destroyed, so we place him in the turn record track for the next turn. And Buell captures Springfield, Missouri, and that earns the Union 1 victory point. Buell's force is demoralized. The victory point increases the Union score now to 11. And if things remain as they are right now in Missouri, the Union will control the state and will gain bonus victory points at the end of the turn. So normally we would place A.P. Hill's counter here because his force was destroyed, but his 2-star promotion counter is here in the leader pool, and it would have entered in this turn, but because his force was destroyed, he is penalized by not being able to enter play until the next turn, so we place his promotion counter in with the leaders that will come in turn 3. Because the Confederates lost Springfield, Missouri, we reduce their victory point score by 1. Now the Union spends its remaining 2 points of dice difference for the purpose of entering 1 Union strength point here in Philadelphia and also a Union leader. So we reduce their reinforcement track by 1 in the east, and we pick a leader randomly, and the result is a 4. A 1-star Union leader. And there's 2 strength points in Philadelphia, so now there's going to be 3. And we place the 1-star leader there, and we have a ocean-going transport also. Now we roll again for another impulse. Union die roll is 7. And the Confederates roll also a 7. And because both sides rolled the same number, 7, we notice that the turn doesn't end. Now we move the table use track to the number 2 spot because this will be the second time we will roll on the command points table. So let's roll first for the Union, and the result is a 10. So the Union receives 4 commands in their primary theater, which in this turn was the West, 3 in its secondary, the East, 2 in its tertiary, the Trans-Mississippi, 2 discretionary, and 2 naval commands. So this is before the additions, and this is after the addition of command points for the Union. Now we roll for the Confederates, and they also roll a 10. So the Confederates had 4 to their primary theater, the Western Theater, 3 to the secondary, the East, 2 to the tertiary, Trans-Mississippi, and 2 discretionary commands. So here's the Confederate track before the addition of command points and after command points are added. So now the command point table use marker is in the number 2 box. If both sides roll identical numbers again and they roll 7s, that will signify the end of this action phase. So we roll again for initiative. The Union rolls a 6, And the South rolls a 9. So the dice difference is 3, and now we enter a free reinforcement for the South. The South will enter a reinforcement point in the West, and it will be placed here in Memphis, where the South have 4 combat factors. Now they have 5 with 2 leaders and a fort. And the Confederates spend all 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern command points for the purpose of rallying the Army of Northern Virginia and eliminating the demoralization marker. And now the rebels are one step closer to attacking a demoralized Army of the Potomac near Washington. Now the Union will spend their 3 points of dice difference and 3 command points in the East for the purpose of rallying the Army of the Potomac. The Union can't have its principal army defending the capital attacked in a demoralized state. We roll again for initiative. The Union die roll is an 11. And the Confederates roll 10. So the Union won the initiative with a dice difference of 1, and they enter a free reinforcement. And they'll spend a reinforcement point from the East to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac, which now is at 8 strength points. The Confederates spend their point of dice difference for the purpose of entering a leader here in Stanton, Virginia, in the Shenandoah Valley. Random roll is a 3. We pick a 1-star leader, and we place him here in Stanton, keeping an eye on those Yankees coming from West Virginia. And the Union spend their point of dice difference and 1 strength point of reinforcements from the Eastern Theater to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac, which now has 9 strength points. Now we roll again for initiative. Union die roll, 8. Confederate die roll, 9. So the Confederates won the initiative with a 1 point of dice difference. Now we enter a free reinforcement. And the Confederates will spend 1 reinforcement point from their Western theater to increase the strength of the Army of the Tennessee, which is currently stationed at Nashville. And its strength goes up now to 4. And the Confederates spend their point of dice difference to pick a leader and place him with the Army of the Tennessee. So we select the leader randomly, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We roll 1d6, and the result is a 5. Stonewall Jackson. So he doesn't go to the Army of the Tennessee. He's promoted, and we place this counter where he is on the map, and he is currently with the Army of Northern Virginia. So we place Jackson's new 2-star version with the Army of Northern Virginia, which is currently squaring off against the Army of the Potomac near Washington. And now the Union spend their point of dice difference and 1 command point from their Western theater in order to move this Union strength point, which is currently in Evansville, Indiana, 4 hexes to join the Union force in New Albany under the command of an unknown 3-star general. Now the Union has 3 strength points in New Albany, right beside the frontier with the state of Kentucky, which is still neutral. Now we roll for initiative once again. The Union die roll, a 6. Confederate die roll, 8. So the Confederates won the initiative with 2 points of dice difference. They enter a free reinforcement. And they'll enter a strength point from the Western Theater to beef up the Army of the Tennessee, which is in Nashville, increasing its strength now to 5. The Union will most likely attack and invade Kentucky in turn three, where there's a special rule that they can use rail lines as if they were friendly. The South knows that, so they may attempt a preemptive invasion of Kentucky in turn two. And to make things more difficult for the Union, the South will place a leader and one strength point here in Knoxville, Tennessee. So they spend 2 points of dice difference. A leader is randomly selected, 1 through 3, 4 through 6. So 2, the one-star leader is selected. And we use 1 point of Western reinforcements. And we place the strength point and the unnamed one-star leader here in Knoxville, Tennessee. Now the Union spends its 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points to move these 2 strength points from Columbus, Ohio to Cincinnati, where the Union now have 4 strength points. Now we roll again for initiative. Union die roll, 12. Uh-oh, this can be a big turn here. A big impulse. And Confederate die roll, 7. And the Union wins the initiative with a dice difference of 5, and they enter a free reinforcement. And they enter a reinforcement point from the Eastern Theater to increase once more the strength of the Army of the Potomac, which now has 10 strength points compared to the Army of Northern Virginia's 8. The situation here is very interesting. Let's remove all the markers except the Army markers so you can see what the situation is in terms of the forces and any terrain nearby. Here we see the Army of Northern Virginia. It is a march away from Washington, crossing a navigable river, Hexside. So the Union cannot risk having the Confederates just march into Washington, and then they may fail reacting into Washington and lose the capital. So the Union is forced to move south across this unnavigable Hexside, which will give the rebels a one-column shift to the left and attack the Army of Northern Virginia. And they have to do that with Banks as the commander of the Army of the Potomac, because the Union has only 4 command points between Eastern and discretionary command points. They don't have enough to demote him and still activate the Army of the Potomac. So the Union will be attacking, but before, it will use 2 of its dice difference, and it will use its last Eastern Theater reinforcement and discretionary reinforcement point to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac to 12. And now it spends its last 3 points of dice difference to spend its last command point from the east and 2 from its discretionary command points to activate the Army of the Potomac, which announces that it will move into the hex occupied by the Army of Northern Virginia. Beauregard will not react. And now we proceed to a major battle. So we start with 12 Union strength points attacking 8 Confederate strength points, and that would be a +4. We would start in the G column, but because the Union crossed an unnavigable river Hexside, there is a 1 column shift to the left. And the attack will be resolved in the F column. Banks gives the Confederates 2 reroll options. Beauregard does not receive any. The Confederate subordinate leaders give their side a +4 die roll modifier, while the Union subordinate leaders only a +1. Important to say that the Union force is a large force. The Confederates with 8 strength points are a medium force. And we roll first for the attacking Union force, 1d6. The roll is a 1 modified to a 2, and the Confederates lose 1 strength point. Not a good result for the Union. Now we roll 1d6 for the Confederates. The result is a 5 modified to a 9, and the Union lose 2 strength points and are demoralized. The Confederates have 2 reroll options, but they will not use them at all, so that's the final result. So the Union loses 2 strength points and are demoralized, and the Confederates 1 strength point. Now we roll for leader loss. If there's any, we will so inform. And rolling on the leader loss table, Breckinridge rolled a 4. He is killed. And his counter is removed permanently from the game. So the demoralized Army of the Potomac retreats once again across its namesake, and we are where we started. And of course, the Army of the Potomac has 2 less strength points. And now the rebels have 5 points of dice difference. The rebels have no eastern command points, but they have 4 discretionary command points, enough to activate the Army of Northern Virginia. This is the situation around Washington. The Union has the capital here with 2 strength points and a fortification. And the effect of the fortification is that it prohibits enemy land movement across the navigable river, which is in the same hex site, in the same hex as the fortification, and one of its hex sites. So the rebels may, however, cross the unnavigable river here and attack the demoralized Army of the Potomac. Let's take a look at a comparison of both armies. Here we see both armies side by side. The numerical advantage goes to the Union with 10 strength points. However, the army is currently demoralized. The Confederates have 7 strength points. And in terms of reroll options, Banks, with his red number 2 there between the 3 and the 2, gives the Army of Northern Virginia 2 die roll reroll options. And tactically, the subordinates from the Army of Northern Virginia give the South a plus 3 die roll, and the subordinates from the Army of the Potomac only a plus 1. So even though the Confederates have less in terms of numbers, qualitatively speaking, they are superior, and it may well be worth a shot attacking the Army of the Potomac. However, by moving into the Army of the Potomac's hex and attacking, the Confederates will suffer 1 column shift to the left. Now, the Army of the Potomac is demoralized, and the effect of attacking a demoralized army is very significant. The demoralized defender causes a 1 column shift to the right, so that would cancel the unnavigable river column shift to the left. And the demoralized force uses a single unmodified die roll, so the Union wouldn't get the plus 1 for Hooker's tactical rating. And worse yet, all the attacker's tactical combat rating modifications and reroll options are doubled. So that means that the Confederates would have 4 reroll options and a plus 6 added to their die roll. So it seems very attractive for the Army of Northern Virginia to make this attack. They may never get so close to Washington in the near future. So let's see what happens. So the Confederates start by spending 2 points of dice difference, and they will spend 1 reinforcement point from the west and their last discretionary reinforcement point to enter a reinforcement in the east. The reinforcement point in the west will be added to the Army of Tennessee, which is in Nashville. Now the Army of Tennessee's strength is increased to 6 strength points. And the discretionary reinforcement point will be added to the Army of Northern Virginia, increasing now its strength to 8 strength points. Now the Confederates spend their last 3 points of dice difference, and 3 of their discretionary command points to activate the Army of Northern Virginia. And the Army of Northern Virginia announces that it will enter the hex occupied by the Army of the Potomac by crossing this unnavigable river. Hex side. Now the Union must make a decision. Do they stand and fight and at least get that +1 for the unnavigable river hex side? Or they will attempt to react, and if they successfully react, they can retreat only here and here, and also conceivably here. They cannot retreat into Washington because Washington is adjacent to the rebel hex. So Banks decides to stand and fight. So now we have a battle in the outskirts of Washington. So let's go now to the battle map. So we start with 8 attacking combat strength points against 10 defending combat strength points, and that's a -2. So we begin in column D. Because the Confederates are crossing an unnavigable river hex side, one column is shifted to the left, so we're at column C. But because the defenders are demoralized, there's a column shift to the right, so we're back again to column D. And Banks would normally give the Confederates 2 reroll options, but because the Union force is demoralized, the Confederates have a total of 4 reroll options. And the Confederate subordinate leaders provide a +3 die roll to their cause, but because, again, the defenders are demoralized, the modifier is doubled, and it is +6. And worse yet, the Union gets no modification, so we're ready to roll. And before rolling, it is important to state that the Confederates are a medium force with 8 strength points. The Union is a large force with 10, so we roll 1d6 for the Confederates. The result is a 6 modified to a 12, demoralization and 2 strength points of losses on the Union Army. Now we roll 1d6 for the Union. The result is a 5, which is not modified, also demoralization and 2 points of strength loss. So result is similar on both sides, because the rebels are attacking, they would have to retreat. So that forces them to use one of their reroll options, and they will reroll the Union die. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 3, which is not modified, and now the result is demoralization and 1 strength point lost. The Confederates still have 3 reroll options, but looking at the combat results table, the Confederates would need to roll a 1 to get a better result, which would be just 1 strength point lost. If they roll a 3 or higher for the Union die roll, the result will be a D2. So the Confederates will not roll anymore, and this will be the final result. The Army of the Potomac loses 2 strength points and remains demoralized. The Army of Northern Virginia loses 1 strength point. Its strength goes down to 7 and is also demoralized. And now we will roll off camera to see if there are any leader losses. And there are no leader losses on any of the sides. So the Army of the Potomac retreats into the hex immediately to the north of Washington. Note that it couldn't retreat into Washington because Washington was in the reaction radius of the Army of Northern Virginia when the Army of Northern Virginia was here. So that's the end of the combat. So now we go to the next impulse and we roll for initiative. The Union die roll is a 6. Here it is. And the Confederate die roll is a 9. So the Confederates are winning a lot of these initiative die rolls in this turn. So we mark the dice difference. The Confederates have the initiative and they enter a free reinforcement. And they will use their last point of reinforcements in the west. And that reinforcement point will be used to increase the strength of the rebels here, which are presently in Knoxville, Tennessee, under their command of an unnamed one-star general. Now they have two strength points. It's important to note that the Confederates don't have enough discretionary command points to rally the Army of Northern Virginia, so the attention will be focused to the other theaters of war. Well, the Confederates don't want to wait till the next turn to see those Union forces coming down to Tennessee via the friendly Union rail lines in the neutral state of Kentucky. So the Confederates spend their 3 points of dice difference and three Western theater command points to activate the Army of Tennessee, which is currently in Nashville. It will move four hexes, entering and passing through Bowling Green to take position here behind the Green River. And we mark the rebel control of Bowling Green with a rebel control marker, and Bowling Green is worth one victory point for the Southern cause. And we mark it here in the general records track, and they have one victory point. Because the South invaded Kentucky, we have a militia from Kentucky now being friendly to the Union, and we place it in a victory point city, and it will be placed here in Louisville, and it will be treated as a regular one-strength Union strength point. The Union forces in New Albany, Indiana, are only three strength points, and it's going to be hard for them to take the Army of Tennessee, which has double at six. So the Union will start by spending 1 point of dice difference and a Western theater command point to move the strength point here, which is the Kentucky militia, into New Albany. And now the Union has four strength points in New Albany. Now the Union spends its last 2 points of dice difference and two more Western theater command points to move two Union strength points from Indianapolis south also to New Albany, increasing the Union strength there to six strength points. Now the Union is at parity with the Army of the Tennessee. Each side has six strength points. Now we go to another impulse. We roll for the Union, a seven. And now the Confederates, 11. So the Confederates have a dice difference of four, and they won the initiative, so they enter a free reinforcement. They don't have any strength point reinforcement, so they will enter their last leader in the leader pool, and the leader will be placed with the Army of Tennessee. So we will place it here in the holding box for the Army of Tennessee. Now the Confederates have four dice difference points to spend. Here we have the situation around Washington, both armies demoralized. And the rebels don't have enough command points to rally their army. Only one discretionary command point, no Eastern theater command points. Note that the Yankees have a similar situation. Just one discretionary command point, no Eastern theater command points. So unless we have new levels of command points coming in as a result of both sides rolling identical initiative die rolls and the turn not ending, the action phase not ending, there's not going to be much more action in the Eastern theater. The rebels spend 1 point of dice difference and a Trans-Mississippi command point for the purpose of moving this Confederate strength point here to Madison, Arkansas, which is a victory point city in the Trans-Mississippi theater. And the Confederates spend their last 3 points of dice difference and their last 3 points of command points in the West. For the purpose of activating this two-star unnamed leader and four of the five strength points in Memphis, Tennessee, to move the four strength point fours, four hexes here, to keep the Yankees around Cairo honest, and especially McClernand's force, which is across the Mississippi in swampland. Now the Union has 4 points of dice difference to spend. The Union has much more in terms of options of spending command points. They have 3 Western command points left, 2 Trans-Mississippi, 4 naval command points left, and 1 discretionary. The Union will spend 1 point of dice difference for the purpose of entering a reinforcement. And given the present set of circumstances in Kentucky, the Union will place a leader reinforcement here in Cincinnati, Ohio. There's 9 leaders in the Union leader pool. We roll 1d10 to make a random selection. And the roll is a 6, so the leader selected is a naval leader, David Farragut. And he's placed here in Cincinnati, not exactly what the Union wanted. They wanted a regular land leader, but Farragut is there for now. Now the Yankees spend 2 more points of dice difference. For the purpose of entering all their naval reinforcements from the naval pool, there's only 1 riverine transport. The transport will be placed here in Cairo, where there's foot and another Union transport. So now there are 2 riverine transports, and there's also a Union strength point there. The Union spend their last point of dice difference to enter a reinforcement. They will enter a reinforcement strength point from the west, and it will enter also here in Cairo, Illinois, where there is currently 1 strength point. Now there's 2. Now we proceed to roll for a new impulse. The Union die roll is 6. Confederate die roll is 3. So the Union win the initiative, 3 points of dice difference. First, we enter their free reinforcement, and they will enter a leader. So we will roll for 1 leader to be selected randomly to be placed in Cincinnati, Ohio. This time the roll is a 3. We pick an unnamed 1-star general, and he's placed in Ohio. There's 4 strength points there. He can only move a maximum of 2. With 3 points of dice difference left, the Union has various options. They could move this force and attack the Army of Tennessee, but both forces have 6 strength points. So that is not a very safe proposition. The Union can still bring more reinforcements in the West. They have a considerable number left to bring, and they could create an army in New Albany, which would allow them to bring even more leaders. So the Yankees spend their last 3 points of dice difference. They'll spend 1 point of Western reinforcements and 2 points of Western command points for the purpose of creating the Army of the Cumberland here in New Albany, Cincinnati. It'll have the be commanded by an unnamed 3-star general, and the army will have a strength of 6. We'll keep track of its strength here in this display, and the reinforcement point will be also added to the Army of the Cumberland, and its strength is now 7. Now the Confederates have to spend 3 points of dice difference, and all they have left is 2 command points in the Trans-Mississippi and 1 discretionary command point. And they'll spend all 3 points of dice difference, and they spend 2 Trans-Mississippi and 1 discretionary command point, and they're left with no command points for now. To build a fort here in Madison, Arkansas, where there is a strength point and a supply depot. Now we roll for the next impulse. Confederates have no more command points or reinforcements. Union die roll is a 3. Confederate die roll is a 7. So the Confederates have 4 points of dice difference to spend. The problem is they don't have any reinforcement left or any command points left, so we practically skip their pulse. And now we go to the Union pulse, 4 points of dice difference to spend. They, for now, will spend 2, and 2 naval command points. The Union sea lift capacity is reduced by 2 for the purpose of using sea movement to move 2 of the 3 strength points in Philadelphia. And those 2 strength points will move in a southerly direction down the Delaware Bay and reaching here, Fort Monroe, Virginia, where the Union has already 2 more strength points for a total strength now of 4. Now the Yankees spend their last 2 points of dice difference to enter a reinforcement in the west and a reinforcement in the Trans-Mississippi. The western reinforcement will enter in Cairo, Illinois, increasing the Union strength there to 3 strength points. In the Trans-Mississippi, we place 1 Union strength point in St. Louis. We roll again for initiative. Only the Union will be able to do anything. 8, and the Confederates 9. Confederates win by 1, but they don't have anything. There are no reinforcements, no command points. So the Union has 1 point of dice difference, and they will spend it now. They will pick a leader to join the Army of the Cumberland. So we roll 1 die to select the leader randomly. And the randomly selected leader is... this is Joseph Hooker. And he is placed here in New Albany, Indiana, with the Army of the Cumberland. And he'll be a subordinate leader of an unnamed 3-star general. Rolling again for initiative, the Union, 8. Confederates, 5. Union wins the initiative, dice difference of 3. Now we enter their free reinforcement. And we'll enter a reinforcement strength point from the west. And the strength point will enter at Cairo, Illinois, where the Union now has 4 strength points. Now the Union spends its 3 points of dice difference, as well as 2 points of command points from the Trans-Mississippi and 1 discretionary command point for a total of 3 command points. And the Union will rally the force of Don Carlos Buell in Springfield, Illinois, so it is no longer demoralized. The Confederates cannot do anything. They don't have any reinforcements or command points. So we roll for initiative once again. Union die roll is a 4. Confederate die roll, 10. So it's a dice difference of 6 for the Confederates. They cannot do anything. So the Union now spends 6 points of dice difference. And they start by spending 4 points of dice difference to enter 4 strength points in the west. 2 of the strength points will enter in Cairo, Illinois, where the Union now has 6 strength points. And 2 strength points will be placed with the Army of the Cumberland in New Albany. And that army now increases its strength to 9 strength points. And wanting to pick some victory points, the Union will spend 1 point of dice difference and its last Western Theater command point to activate 1 strength point of its force in Cincinnati, Ohio. And that lone strength point can move over neutral hexes, so it will move 4 hexes through Lexington and into Frankfort, Kentucky, capturing both cities for the Union, adding 2 victory points to the Union score, which is now 13. And the Union spends its last point of dice difference to enter a leader. And the leader will be added to the Army of the Potomac. The random roll is a 1, so it is this unnamed 2-star general. And it will be placed, he will be placed here with the Army of the Potomac. Now the Army of the Potomac has 4 subordinate generals. And we roll again for a new impulse. The Union die roll is 5. Confederate die roll is 6. Confederates won, but they can't do anything to affect the impulse. So the Union has 1 point of dice difference, which it spends now. And they decide to select a leader to go to the Army of the Cumberland, and the random result produces a 2, so it is this unnamed 1-star general. And that general goes here with the Army of the Cumberland, which is currently New Albany, Indiana. And this army now has 2 subordinate leaders. Yet we roll again for another impulse. The Union die roll is 6. Let's put it here, 6. And the Confederate die roll is 8. Confederates win, but they cannot do anything in this impulse, so the Union spends 2 points of dice difference, and the Union will spend its 2 remaining naval command points, reducing further its sea lift capacity now to 2. To move 2 strength points here to Fortress Monroe through sea movement, the first one is this one here in Baltimore. You can move down the Chesapeake Bay and reach Fort Monroe. And the other strength point is this one in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. It can move along this navigable river and reach also Chesapeake Bay, and therefore reaching Fort Monroe. Now in Fort Monroe, there's a total of 6 Union strength points with a 3-star unnamed leader. The Union only has 4 leaders to enter to end this action round. We roll again for initiative. The Union rolls a 6. And the Confederates also a 6. The action round is not over because it would have been over if both rolls would have been 7s. So now we move this table use marker to the number 3 box. And we roll again for commands for each side. We roll for the Union first. The roll is an 8, so we add 6 commands to the primary or Western Theater, 4 to the East Theater, 1 to the Trans-Mississippi, 1 discretionary, and 3 naval command points. And here we have the new command point levels for the Union. Now we roll for the Confederates. The roll is a 7, 6 to their primary theater, which is also the West, 4 for the East, 1 for the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 discretionary command points. And here we see the new command point levels for the Confederates. Now we roll for the initiative. The Union die roll is 4. Confederate die roll is a 2. So the Union wins a dice difference, or the initiative, the dice difference of 2, and because they won the initiative, they enter a free reinforcement. They will place a leader with the Army of the Cumberland, so we roll 1d6 to see who that is. And the leader that enters is Steele, and Steele is already in the game. So he is in his 1-star version with the Army of the Potomac, so now we substitute that counter for his 2-star version, which is not better. And the Union will spend its last 2 points of dice difference to enter 2 leaders. One will go with the Army of the Potomac, and that is the unnamed 1-star general. And we place him with the other subordinate leaders. Now there's 5 of them. And the other leader will be placed in Philadelphia. And the random result is a 1. So that is... this is David Porter. And he's placed here in Philadelphia where there's already one ocean-going transport with a leader and one strength point. The Rebels spend 1 dice difference point and 1 Trans-Mississippi command point for the purpose of moving the strength point here in Madison, Arkansas, right across the Mississippi to Memphis, Tennessee, where it joins the Rebel force there. Now the Rebels have 2 strength points there with a 1-star general and a fort. Confederates spend their last point of dice difference and 1 Eastern Theater command point. And they will move 1 of the 4 strength points in Richmond, 2 hexes to their fort guarding the Virginia Peninsula there, where the Confederates have 1 strength point. Now they have 2 with a 1-star unnamed leader and fortifications. In a previous impulse, we forgot to deduct 2 naval command points that the Union used, so we do it now, so they only have 1. And now we roll for a new impulse. Union die roll is... it's going to be a 6? No, 5. And the Confederate die roll is 6. So the Confederates win the initiative. Now they can enter free reinforcement. But as you can see here, they have no reinforcement strength points. And up here, no leaders in the leader pool. So they lose that advantage of entering a free reinforcement. And they spend their point of dice difference and 1 Western Theater command point for the purpose of moving by rail 1 of the strength points that the Rebels currently have here in Knoxville. They have 2 strength points there, so they will move 1 using rail movement. And we reduce the Rebel raid capacity for this turn from 4 to 3. And the strength point will move along friendly rail lines through Nashville to join the Army of Tennessee, which now increases its strength to 7 strength points. And the Union will spend its point of dice difference to enter Leader Schofield, a 2-star leader now, and he'll be placed with the Army of the Cumberland. And now that army has 3 subordinate leaders. Roll for initiative. Still a significant number of command points left. The Union roll is a 6, and the Confederates roll 8. So the Confederates win the initiative, but they don't have any reinforcements in the form of strength points or leaders to enter. With a dice difference of 2, the Confederates don't have enough a dice difference to move the Army of the Tennessee or any of these forces here in the Western Theater. In the same situation in the Eastern Theater, they cannot rally the Army of Northern Virginia or activate any of these leaders. They have to spend 2 points of dice difference, and we'll spend 2 more Western command points. First command point will be to activate the leader alone, and he can move for free along friendly rail hexes, and he will join the Army of Tennessee. Now that army has 2 subordinate leaders. And the second command point will be used to move this strength point using rail movement along friendly rail hexes to join the Army of Tennessee, which now has 8 strength points. Now the Union spends its point of dice difference and 1 Trans-Mississippi command point to move this strength point, which is here in Lexington, Missouri, 4 hexes, on its way to join Buell's force in Springfield. And to another impulse, Union die roll is a 7. And if a 7 is rolled, the action phase will end right here. So the Confederates roll 6. The union wins the initiative and it doesn't have any leaders to enter or strength points, so it spends its point of dice difference and a Western Theater command point.
For the purpose of moving this union's strength point through the rail system in Illinois to Cairo, and it will join there the union force that now totals 7 strength points, and the union has still a rail capacity of 5 strength points. Now the Confederates spend their point of dice difference and 1 Eastern Theater command point for the purpose of moving also by rail this Confederate strength point from Raleigh, North Carolina, north to Richmond, Virginia, where it will join a rebel force, and now the rebels have 4 strength points there. They only have 1 point of rail capacity. Now we roll again for impulse. The Union rolls an 8. The Confederates roll a 6. So the Union wins the initiative with a dice difference of 2. They would normally enter a reinforcement, but they don't have any leaders in their leader pool, nor any reinforcement or strength points left. So we go straight to the first point of dice difference to be spent, and 1 Eastern command point is spent to move this strength point from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, using the Union rail system, all the way to the east of Philadelphia, where now the Union has 2 strength points. That uses 1 point of rail capacity, which is now lowered to 4. And the other point of dice difference is used together with a Western command point to move this strength point, which is currently in Frankfort, Kentucky, through Lexington and south all the way down to Mill Springs, thereby controlling these 2 cities in Kentucky. And Kentucky is almost in the hands of the Union. The Confederates have the Army of Tennessee stationed to the northeast of Bowling Green and practically surrounded by Union forces. So the Union increases its victory point score now with the capture of those cities to 15. Now the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Eastern Theater command points for the purpose of placing a depot here in this city in Virginia, which is overlooking the Allegheny Mountains. Now we roll again for another round of initiative. Union rolls a 2. That's a very dangerous low total. Let's see what the Confederates roll. And they roll another 2. So now we have another situation where we must roll for command points again, and the turn doesn't end because none of the numbers listed there were rolled. So now we roll on the command points table. For the Union, the roll is an 8, so that will be 6 commands in their primary theater: the West, 4 in the East, 1 in the Trans-Mississippi, 1 discretionary, and 3 naval commands to be added to their current levels. And here are the levels of each. Notice that the Western command points total 10. 7 in the East, 4 naval, 2 discretionary, and 1 in the Trans-Mississippi. Now we roll for the rebels. The roll is a 2, so they add 6 to the Western Theater, 3 to the Eastern, 2 to the Trans-Mississippi, and 3 discretionary command points. Here are the levels before making the additions, and now after, notice that the rebels have 9 in the West, 4 discretionary, 3 in the East, and 2 in the Trans-Mississippi. And now we move the marker to the number 4 box in the table use track. And now any further identical result by both sides will end the action phase. So we roll again for another impulse. The Union rolls a 12. Oh, that's very high. Let's see what the Confederates roll. They roll a 5. So the difference is 7. This can be a significant impulse. The Union has a dice difference of 7 points. And they have a lot of options in terms of command points, especially in the West. So let's see what happens. In the East, for now, you see that both main armies are demoralized near Washington. And there's not a lot in terms of command points, probably just enough to rally both armies and not much else unless discretionary command points are used. So the Union will use 3 of its dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points for the purpose of rallying the Army of the Potomac, and we remove the demoralization marker. And now the Union spends 3 more points of dice difference, this time also spending 3 command points from the Eastern Theater for the purpose of activating the Army of the Potomac and announce that it will enter the hex occupied by the Army of Northern Virginia, which is demoralized. And as you've seen before, there are severe penalties to a defending force or army when it is demoralized. And the Confederates can try to avoid battle, but their reaction die roll has to be reduced by 1 because they are demoralized. So Beauregard, in abundance of caution, will attempt to react to avoid battle with the Army of the Potomac. He rolls a 5, reduced to a 4, and he succeeds in reacting and he moves south. But Banks and the Army of the Potomac continue to press on, and they will attempt and announce to enter Beauregard's hex. So Beauregard again will attempt to react to avoid battle with the Army of the Potomac. And again, Beauregard has 1 die roll, and 1 has to be subtracted because the Army of Northern Virginia is currently demoralized. Note that Beauregard can continue to retreat south, but there will be no river between both forces. So Beauregard will roll for reaction. The die roll is a 6, reduced to a 5, and the Army of Northern Virginia successfully reacts once again, and it moves south, further into Virginia, and it is about to cross now the Rappahannock River. This is an unnavigable river. The Army of the Potomac continues pressing on and announces its intention to enter that hex occupied by the rebels, and Beauregard now decides to continue to retreat south, this time to take advantage of the river hex side. So he rolls for reaction, but unfortunately is not able to react, and there will be a battle north of the Rappahannock River. So now on to the battle. The Union with 8 strength points attacks the Confederates with 7, and the Confederates are demoralized. We start in column F, but because the Confederate force is demoralized, column shift is 1 to the right, and we're in column G. And it is important to note that Banks normally would give 2 reroll options to the Confederates because he's a terrible army commander, but because the Confederates are demoralized, they do not receive any column shifts at all. Worse yet, the Confederate demoralized force gives 1 reroll option to any enemy force attacking it, so Banks' army gets that free reroll option. Also, the Confederates get no die roll modifiers from their leaders. And the Union has 2 unnamed leaders, which we have to determine who they are. And 1 is Hancock, which is a good leader, giving a +1 die roll modifier. The other one is Howard. Howard has a red 2 tactical rating, meaning that it would normally give die roll modifiers to the enemy. Because the enemy is demoralized, it will receive none. So the Union has a total of +4 die roll modifier because of tactical ratings. The Union rolls a 5 modified to a 9. And that causes demoralization and a loss of 2 strength points on the rebel army. And now the rebels roll 1d6 with no modification whatsoever. And the die roll is a 3. And that causes 1 strength point loss on the Union army. Now, this is clearly so far a Union victory. The Union will not risk re-rolling its die and will accept this result. So the Union wins this battle. And in regards to possible leader loss, no leader losses occur as a result of this battle. So now we modified the strengths of the armies. The Army of Northern Virginia has 5 strength points and the Army of the Potomac has 7. And we noticed that Hooker, we had placed Hooker before his 3-star counter with the Army of the Cumberland. So now we place it here with the Army of the Potomac and correct that mistake. Also, it's important to note that Hancock is now eligible for promotion. This is his 2-star counter, and we will place it in the turn record track for the next turn. Now we retreat the Army of Northern Virginia across the Rappahannock, and it remains demoralized. And the Army of the Potomac, if it would have more command points, could really continue to inflict severe damage on the rebels. Now the Union spends its last point of dice difference and a naval command point for the purpose of moving 1 strength point from the port of Philadelphia using Union sea movement south all the way to Fort Monroe on the Virginia Peninsula, where the Union now has a 3-star general and 7 strength points. Now the Confederates spend 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern command points for the purpose of rallying the demoralized Army of Northern Virginia, removing any further danger of another attack. And the Confederates could activate the Army of Tennessee. It could move north and attack the Army of the Cumberland at New Albany, but it would be across a navigable river. That is a 2-column shift to the left, and the Confederates, anyway, would be outnumbered. They have 8 strength points, and the Army of the Cumberland 9, so that is not a very reasonable option. And if the Army moves to get rid of this strength point, it will leave the path open for the Army of the Cumberland to march south, and it would be hard for the rebel forces to join before facing the Army of the Cumberland. So turning to West Tennessee, the rebels are facing here 2 forces. McClernand has 4 strength points, and he's presently in a swampland across the Mississippi, but the Union has 7 strength points here in Cairo, and between both forces, it's 11 strength points. The rebels only have 4. So discretion is the better side of valor here. The Confederates will spend 3 points of dice difference and 3 Western Theater command points to move their force here 4 hexes back to Memphis, where it will join with 2 other Confederate strength points to make a total of 6, and they have also a fortification there. The rebels spend their last point of dice difference and 1 discretionary command point for the purpose of having 1 strength point from those stationed in Richmond to move 2 hexes to join the Army of Northern Virginia, increasing its strength now to 6. Now we proceed to another impulse in this never-ending turn, number 2. 5 for the Union, and the Confederates
Roll a six. And the rebels have 1 point of dice difference. They cannot enter any free reinforcements because they have none. So they spend 1 point of dice difference. And Trans-Mississippi Command Point to move their strength point that is currently in Fayetteville to this other town here, Clarksville. It's basically getting them out of Dodge, because Buell at any time can obviously reach Fayetteville. Now the Union spends its point of dice difference and its last Trans-Mississippi command point to move this strength point that came south from Lexington to join Buell's force in Springfield, and now Buell has five strength points there. And yet we go to another round, another impulse. Union die roll is a seven, and the Confederates roll an eight. So the Confederates won the initiative. They have no reinforcements to enter. They spend 1 point of dice difference. And they'll spend it in the Trans-Mississippi Theater, and they don't wish to move anything there, so they just waste a command point. And the idea behind that is to not touch the Western command points, because with six, they can activate the Army of Tennessee twice. And the same happens with the discretionary command points. With three, they can activate the Army of Northern Virginia once. The Union spends its point of dice difference, and they will spend one naval command point, and they will do the same thing. They don't wish to move anything, so it's just wasted. So, next impulse. And we roll for the Union. Five. Confederates roll. Nine. And that is a four-point difference. So, the Confederates had the initiative. No reinforcements to enter, but they have 4 points of dice difference to spend. And the Confederates spend 3 points of dice difference and their last three discretionary command points for the purpose not of activating the Army of Northern Virginia, to activate this force here, which is to the north of Strasburg here in the Shenandoah Valley. Three strength points. And let's mark the Union-controlled rail line so that there is no doubt here. The Union controls this rail line here. So this force moves first into this hex. Now it moves into the hex that the Union occupied, which has the rail line running through it. Now, having entered the reaction radius of the Army of the Potomac, now the Army of the Potomac has a tough choice to make. Does it leave that Confederate force in its rear? Conceivably, it could even reach Washington, or will it attempt to react and engage in combat? And Banks will attempt to react. And he needs higher than three to be able to react, so 1d6 is rolled. And Banks successfully reacts, and now we resolve the battle. And three Confederate strength points attacking seven Union strength points. That is a 1-3 attack. We have to reveal who the Confederate three-star general is, and it is Joe Johnston. Not bad. So the Confederates have a tactical die roll modifier of plus one for Joe Johnston, but also plus two for Howard. So that is a plus three. The Union have a plus one for Hancock's tactical rating. As to reroll options, Johnston does not give his side a reroll option because he's not commanding an army, but Banks is and gives the Confederates two reroll options. So we roll for the Confederates 1d6. The result is a 5, and that is a no effect. And now we roll 1d6 for the Union. It was a 1 modified to a 2. The Confederates suffer a demoralization and 2 result. The Confederates will re-roll their own die roll to see if they can get a better result against the Union. We roll 1d6, and it's a 1, and that still produces no favorable result. So the Confederates will use their last re-roll option. They roll 1d6. 1 modified to a 4, and it still is a no effect. So the Confederates lose 2 strength points and are now demoralized. And in the ensuing leader check, Hancock rolled a 4, so he is killed. Howard is eligible for promotion, so he places 3-star counter in the turn track for next turn. So Johnston has to retreat, and now Johnston is practically sandwiched between 2 much more significant Union forces. Confederates spend the last point of dice difference, and they have no choice but to spend a Western Theater command point. But they will not move any of their forces in the West, so the point is wasted. And now it's the Union's turn to spend 4 points of dice difference. Joe Johnston's move that attracted the Army of the Potomac may have bought some time for Beauregard. But it's now the Union's turn, and the Army of the Potomac could move south and attack Beauregard, but it would be across an unnavigable river, and the Army of the Potomac just doesn't have that quality of leaders to gain any advantage there. So, the Yankees will spend 3 points of dice difference, and also their last Eastern command point and 2 discretionary command points. To activate this Union force here with 3 strength points to attack Joe Johnston's demoralized force, which has 2. Johnston can react and attempt to save his force by reacting here into Strasburg, but his force is demoralized. He has to roll higher than his initiative rating. He has to roll 4 or more, but because his force is demoralized, there's a -1 die roll modifier. The roll is a 2, so Johnston fails to react, and on we go with the battle. The initial differential is a +1, but the Yankees crossed an unnavigable river. So that shifts the column 1 to the left to column E. But the defenders are demoralized, and we're back to column F. Now we reveal who the Union 3-star leader is. And it's William Rosecrans, so it could have been a lot worse. Because the rebels are demoralized, they don't receive the tactical die roll modifier for Johnston. And worse yet, the Yankees, who would have no die roll modifier, receive a +1 minimum die roll modifier and also 1 reroll option. So we roll for the Union first, 1d6. A 1 modified to a 2, no damage to the Confederates. Now we roll 1d6 for the Confederates. The result is a 4, and the Union force is demoralized. But the Union has 1 reroll option, and now they will exercise it to reroll their die. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 2 modified to a 3, demoralization. So both forces inflict the same damage on each other. So there's no strength point loss, but both forces are demoralized. And also there was no leader loss. Because each side suffered the same result, the Union has to retreat. And they do so back to the space where they started from. The Union spends their remaining point of dice difference, and they will be forced to spend a naval command point, even though they wish to move no units through the sea at this time. It's important to note that the Union still has 10 Western Theater command points available. We proceed to another round, this never-ending turn. 6 for the Union. And 3 for the Confederates. And the Union cannot enter reinforcements, but it will spend all 3 points of dice difference. And 3 Western Theater Command points, and it now has 7 remaining. And the Union will move the Army of the Cumberland, at last, out of Indiana. It will move here, capture Louisville, here in order to maintain control of this rail line, and end its move here, adjacent to the Army of the Tennessee. And with the capture of Louisville, the Union gains 2 more victory points, raising its score to 17. Now the Confederates spend their 3 points of dice difference. They don't have any other way of spending it but to burn 3 Western Theater command points. And with more Union troops pouring into Kentucky, the Confederates will activate the Army of Tennessee. And it will move into the hex occupied by the Army of the Cumberland. Now we have to see who the commander of the Army of the Cumberland is to see if he can successfully react. Of course, that is, if the Union wants to react. The Army of the Cumberland has 1 more strength point than the Rebel Army, so it will not react. And on we go with another battle. So we start in column D because there's 8 Rebel strength points attacking 9 Yankee strength points. There's a column shift to the left because the Rebels are attacking across an unnavigable river, so we're now in column C. Now we reveal who the unknown leaders are for both sides. And here we see the leaders. The Union commander is Henry Halleck, one of the worst commanders in the game. And here we see them. The Union commander is Henry Halleck, one of the worst commanders in the game. But there's Thomas, which is a very good subordinate, and Schofield, who's already revealed. On the Rebel side, the commander is Robert E. Lee, the best in the game, and Braxton Bragg is a subordinate as well as Sterling Price. Now, an interesting situation because of Robert E. Lee, the Confederates have 3 reroll options plus 2 that Henry Halleck gives to them. So it's 5 reroll options, but no tactical die roll modifiers. And the Union has a plus 2 die roll modifier. And number-wise, obviously, the Union has more men than the Confederates, and the Confederates are crossing an unnavigable river. So we start by rolling 1d6 for the Confederates. The roll is a 6, which is not modified, and this is a demoralization and 1 strength point loss on the Union Army. That's the best result the Confederates can aspire here in this combat. So now we roll 1d6 for the Union. 5 modified to a 7, d3, and obviously the Confederates will be using one of their reroll options to see if they can reroll the Union die roll. So we reroll it one more time. The result is a 6, another D3, so the Confederates will burn another reroll option to reroll once again. 3 modified to a 5, D2, still not good enough, and we reroll again. 4 modified to a 6, still D2. We roll the dice once again, and the Confederates have 1 option left. 3 modified to a 5, still D2, so they burn their last reroll option. And they frankly need just a 1 or a 2 to get the same result as they inflicted on the Union. So we roll 1d6. A 1 modified to a 3, so that's a D1 result. A 1 modified to a 3, D1 result. So both sides get the same result. And because the Confederates were attacking, they are considered to have lost the battle and have to retreat. So here we have the casualties taken to the strength points. And as their leader loss, only Schofield had a leader loss result. He is wounded, so we placed him in the track for the next turn. And we note that Thomas and Price will be eligible for promotion next turn. So we place their promotion counters in the turn track for next turn.
So the Army of Tennessee returns to the hex from which it attacked, and that's the end of that battle.
We go for another impulse, and the Union die roll is a 9. Confederates roll an 8. The Union wins the initiative with no reinforcements to enter. They spend their dice difference point, and they'll just burn another naval command point, which is their last. They will not do anything with it. Now the Confederates have to spend their point of dice difference and spend one Western command point, and they will use it to send one strength point from Memphis, where the rebels have 6 strength points. One will be sent by rail movement all the way to reach the Army of Tennessee. So we move it here. And the Army of Tennessee increases its strength from 7 to 8 strength points. And that uses up the last point of rail capacity for the rebels for this turn. Now we roll again for another round. Another impulse, 11, 11 for the Union. Confederates roll 7. And the Union cannot enter reinforcements. It'll use all their 4 points of dice difference. And 4 of its Western command points, reducing its total now to 3. In order to rally the Army of the Cumberland, and here you see how Henry Halleck hurts the cause. If he would have been a commander with a 3, a rating of 3 as an initiative rating, the Union could have sent one strength point by rail movement to increase the strength of the Army of the Cumberland and also rally the Army of the Cumberland in this impulse, and it would still have 3 command points for a possible later activation and an attack on a demoralized Army of Tennessee. But because of Henry Halleck being less than competent, the Union has to spend all 4 of its dice initiative and command points to rally the Army of the Cumberland. So the Union has 3 Western command points left, and the rebels have 1 Western command point left, and we roll now for another impulse. We roll for the Union a 6, and rebels roll a 3, a 3-point difference, and this will be the last impulse. The Union wins the initiative. There's no reinforcements. They spend all 3 points of dice difference. And the last Western Theater command points to activate their force here in Cairo, Illinois. There is a 3-star general, naval leader Foote, 2 riverine transports, and 7 strength points. The Union will activate the 3-star general with the 6 strength points. The force will move into Paducah, taking control of that city in Kentucky, into this Woods Hex, and then it will attack the Confederate forts, or fort here. So let's go to that battle. The Union has 6 strength points, the Confederate has 1. There's a number of column shifts that apply. Because the Union crossed a navigable river, there is a 2-column shift to the left. Also, because the Confederates are in a fort, there's another column shift. That's 3 column shifts. And because this is a woods hex, there's a forest hex, there's a 4th column shift. So this attack is resolved in the 2-to-1 column. Now we see who the Union commander is. And it is Irvin McDowell. So now we roll for the Union. The result is an unmodified 4. It causes a D1 result on the Confederates. Now we roll 1d6 for the Confederates. The roll is a 3, modified to a 4 because McDowell has a red 1. And that is a 4, which produces no effect on the Union force. So the result of this combat is that the strength points of the rebels are destroyed, and also the fortification, and the Union occupies the Hex. Now the Southerners spend their point of dice difference and their last Western Theater command point. It will be used to move a leader from the Army of the Tennessee. Braxton Bragg will move 10 hexes to reach Memphis here. So we take Bragg's counter, and he reaches Memphis, Tennessee. He will be the ranking commander there in that city where there are 5 rebel strength points. So that's the end of the action phase, and now we check the command point table use marker, and it is in the number 4 box. So we increase the command point table total marker 4 boxes now to box number 5. Now we go to the rally phase, where each demoralized force loses a strength point, and if it's in supply, it gets rallied. If not, it maintains its demoralized status. Here in Kentucky, we have the Army of Tennessee, which is now rallied, and it is in supply. But it loses a strength point, so it is now down to 7. In the Eastern Theater, we have Rosecrans' force here, which is demoralized, and it now loses 1 strength point. And it has now 2. And here we see Joe Johnston's rebel force. It has only 1 strength point, so that strength point is eliminated. And we place Joe Johnston with the rebel leaders that are scheduled to enter in the next turn. Now we check Missouri. Missouri has all its victory point cities in Union control, so the Union receives 6 additional victory points, which is the number of victory points which is worth all of Missouri's victory point cities. So this is a bonus that the Union receives for controlling all of the state's cities. And that increases their victory point score to 23. The Union has gained control of all victory point cities in West Virginia, so the same thing happens here, and the Union receives a bonus of 5 victory points. And its victory point score increases now to 28. And that's the end of turn number 2 in our playthrough of the 1861 scenario of Victory Games, the Civil War. We go to turn 3, a winter turn, November 1861 to February 1862. We start by placing the available leaders in their respective leader pools. The Confederates have 8 leaders, of which 3 are unnamed. The Union has 5 leaders, of which 1 is an unnamed cavalry leader. We record now the levels of reinforcement points available. Notice that it is significantly less than the other turn. In the east for the Confederates, 4. 4 in the west, none in the Trans-Mississippi, and 1 discretionary reinforcement point, and rail capacity remains at 4. And we mark the reinforcement levels on the reinforcement track. And we do the same for the Union, 4 in the east, 4 in the west, none in the Trans-Mississippi, and 1 discretionary reinforcement point.
And here we see those levels recorded on the Union reinforcement track. Union sea lift capacity for this turn is 8 strength points. They receive 2 river and 3 ocean-going transports and 4 river ironclads. And all these naval units are placed in the naval pool. And here they are. They include the river ironclads Pittsburgh, Cairo, Mount City, and Carondelet. Now we go to the command phase. Let's reveal the Union command priority markers that had been placed on the prior turn face down. So here we see the Union priorities. Primary theater will be the east, secondary the west, and tertiary the Trans-Mississippi. Now we roll 1d6 to see what the Confederate resources priorities will be for this turn. The die roll is a 2, so the west will be primary, east secondary, and Trans-Mississippi tertiary. And here we have the markers in the appropriate theaters in terms of priorities. Now we will roll on the command points table for each of the sides. We start with the Union. We roll 2d6, and the roll is a 3, so the primary theater, the east, will receive 4 command points, the west 3, Trans-Mississippi 2, 1 discretionary command point, and 3 naval command points. And here we have the levels of Union command points. Now we roll for Confederate command points. The die roll is a 10, so it will be 4 command points in the west, 3 in the east, 2 in the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 discretionary command points. And here we have the Confederate command point levels for each theater. And since this is the last turn of our scenario, we don't have to select the priorities for the Union for the next turn, so we'll just leave the markers right there. Now to the Confederate Commerce Raiders phase. There are no Confederate Commerce Raiders, so we also skip this phase. Now to the blockade effects phase. The blockade level for this turn is the same as last turn, 10%. We cross-reference the port capacity, which is 40, which is the same as in the last turn, and the blockade percentage is 10. That means that 36 import points arrive in Confederate ports. And we add those 36 import points to our production total, which still is 100, so there will be no change. It's 136 total imports. And again, there will be no ill effect on the Confederates' situation, because that happens when this marker, the imports marker, goes below the 100 mark. And now we start the action phase, and we roll for this impulse for the Union. The roll is a 7. The Confederates also roll a 7. Because both sides rolled the same total, now we move the command point table use marker to the number 2 box. And in the event that they roll a 7 in any of the additional or future impulses, the turn may end. Now, there's a special rule that prohibits a turn ending without any impulses taking place. And that would happen if we roll now for a new impulse and they roll a 7. But if that happens, then that die roll is ignored and we roll again until we have different results. So we add more command points and we roll first for the Union. And the result is a 9. So 5 command points will be added to the east, 3 to the west, 2 to the Trans-Mississippi, 2 to the discretionary track, and 2 to the naval command track. So here we have the command levels before the new additions, and now after the command points are added. Now we roll for additional command points for the Confederates, and the result is 11, so 5 will be added in the west, 4 in the east, 2 in the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 to the discretionary command point track. So here are the command points before the new additions, and this is after the new command points are added. And now we roll for a new impulse. It is here, if both sides roll the same result, that we roll again until we obtain different results for each side. So we roll for the Union,
The result is a 3. And we roll for the Confederates, and the result is a 7. So the Confederates win the initiative with a dice difference of 4. Because they won the initiative, they can enter a free reinforcement. And the Confederates want to strengthen the Army of Tennessee, which is under the command of Robert E. Lee. So they will select a leader to go to that army. So we will roll one die to randomly select that leader. And the result is a 7, so we select this unnamed one. And we place the leader with the subordinate leaders of the Army of Tennessee. Here we see Lee's Army of Tennessee with 7 strength points facing 8 strength points of Halleck's Army of the Cumberland with an unnavigable river between both armies. So Lee doesn't want to attack directly and with numerical inferiority. So the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater reinforcement points for the purpose of beefing up Lee's army, which will now have 9 strength points, and with the superior leadership of Lee with 3 reroll options, now Lee is in a better position to attack the Army of the Cumberland. So now the Confederates spend their 2 last points of dice difference and 2 Western command points to attack Halleck. So Lee could move directly into Halleck's hex and force him either to accept battle or attempt to react and withdraw. But in that event, Halleck's army would receive a favorable column shift to the left because of the unnavigable river hex side between both armies. Well, the Union knows that in the event of a battle between Halleck and Lee, Lee has 3 reroll options and Halleck will give 2 more to Lee. So Halleck decides to attempt to react to move away from the Army of Tennessee. So we have to roll to see if Halleck successfully reacts, and it has to be higher than his command rating of 4. So he needs a 5 or a 6, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 3. Halleck fails to react. And now Lee will enter Halleck's hex, and Halleck, not wanting to enter into battle with Lee under these conditions, will attempt again to react, and he needs a 5 or 6. So we roll 1d6, and the roll is a 4, and Halleck fails to react once again. So Lee moves into Halleck's hex, and now we have a battle. The attacking rebels have 9 strength points. The defending Union army has 8. So the rebels have a +1 differential. This battle will be resolved in column F. There are no applicable column shifts. Also, Robert E. Lee has an army command rating of 3. So the rebels receive 3 reroll options. And Henry Halleck has an army command rating of 2 in a red box, meaning that he gives the rebels 2 additional reroll options. Now we have to determine the die roll modifiers for each side. The attackers have an unnamed leader. Let's draw from the 1-star leader cup to see who that unnamed leader is. And it is Richard Taylor, and he provides a +1 die roll modifier for the rebel cause, and that comes in handy. And on the Union side, there is Thomas, and he also provides a +1 die roll modifier to the Union die roll. So we're all set to go. Both armies are medium forces in size, so we roll first for the attacking rebels. The roll is a 1 modified to a 2, and they only cause 1 point of strength loss on the Union side. Now we roll for the Union. The result is a 2 modified to a 3, and they cause demoralization and a loss of 1 strength point on the rebel side. And the rebels decide to burn their first reroll option to reroll their own die. So we roll 1d6. And the result is the best they can get, a 6 modified to a 7, demoralization, and 2 strength point losses on the Union side. The rebels still have 4 reroll options. Only on a roll of 1 will they get a better result as to their particular losses than what they have. And on a roll of six, they will get a worse result, which would be a D2. So they will take the chance and they will re-roll the union die roll. The result is a 4 modified to a 5, demoralization and 1 point strength point loss on the Confederates, and they will burn another reroll option to roll the Union die roll once again. The roll is a 5 modified to a 6, demoralization and 1 point of strength loss, not the kind of results the rebels want. They still have 2 reroll options left, and they will burn their next to last option to roll the Union die roll once again. And again, the result is a 5 modified to a 6, demoralization and 1 point of strength loss. They will not reroll that die in order to avoid getting a 6 and a worse result. So that is the end of this combat, and these are the results. So the Yankees lose 2 strength points. And their army is down to 6 and is demoralized. Meanwhile, the rebels lose a strength point. Their army has 8 strength points and they are also demoralized. Now we rolled for leader loss, and Thomas as well as Taylor are both wounded. So this battle will not count for promotion purposes for either of them, and they are placed in the turn record track for the next turn, even though this is the last turn of this scenario. So the Army of the Cumberland loses the battle and retreats one space north in the direction of Louisville. Now, with Lee breathing down his neck, even though both armies are demoralized, Halleck doesn't want to give him a chance to be able to rally and attack him once again. So the Union will spend all 4 points of dice difference and 4 Western Theater command points to rally Halleck's Army of the Cumberland. So we remove the demoralization marker from his army. Now we roll again for initiative. The Union die roll is a 3. Confederate die roll, a 9. That is a 6-point difference. Well, the Confederates win the initiative once again with a 6-point difference, and they enter a free reinforcement. And they will use 1 reinforcement point from the Western Theater to reinforce Lee's Army of Tennessee, which is currently demoralized, but it won't be as that for long, and its strength is increased from 8 to 9 strength points. And the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points for the purpose of rallying Lee's Army of Tennessee. And we remove the demoralization marker. Now the Confederates spend 2 more points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points to activate Lee's army once again. And Lee announces that he will enter the hex occupied by Halleck's Army of the Cumberland. Lee now has 9 strength points, Halleck only 6. Halleck will try to react to avoid combat. He needs a 5 or a 6. We roll 1d6. The roll is a 6, so Halleck successfully reacts and moves into Louisville. Lee can continue moving, and he announces that he will enter Halleck's new hex. Halleck decides that he will continue to attempt to avoid combat with Lee and try to cross that Ohio River. But for that, he has to successfully react, so he needs a 5 or a 6, so he rolls 1d6. But this time, Halleck fails to react, and Lee catches up to him. And we have another battle, this time in Louisville. Lee, with 9 combat factors, attacks Halleck's 6, and that is a plus 3 differential. There are no column shifts. So we will resolve this combat in column G. The Confederates have 5 reroll options, the 3 that Lee gives them, plus 2 that Halleck also gives them. And there are no die roll modifiers for tactical ability. So we roll first for the Confederates, 1d6. And the Confederates obtain their best result, a 6, which is unmodified, causing demoralization and 1 strength point loss on the Union Army. Now we roll 1d6 for the Army of the Cumberland. The result is a 4, also a d1 result against the rebels. So now the rebels will burn their first reroll option to reroll the Union die roll. So and again, an unmodified 4, the same result. So the rebels will burn their second reroll option to roll the Union die roll once again. And now the result is a 1, no loss on the rebel side. And the rebels will not exercise any more reroll options. So the Union army loses 1 strength point and is now demoralized and reduced to 5. The Confederates have no losses in strength points. There are no leader losses, and that's the end of the battle. And as a result of this Confederate victory, Halleck's army retreats into New Albany, Indiana, and Lee captures Louisville, Kentucky. And that adds 2 points to the Confederate victory point score, and now it is at 3. Now the Confederates spend their last 2 points of dice difference, and they'll add a leader and a reinforcement point to the Army of Tennessee. We roll for the leader random selection. The roll is a 7, so this unnamed 1-star rebel leader will join Lee's Army of Tennessee. And the rebels will spend their last western reinforcement point to further increase the strength of the Army of Tennessee to 10 strength points. And now we have to spend 4 points of dice difference for the Union, and the Union have a dilemma in the West. They only have 2 Western command points left. Of course, they could add discretionary command points, and that would be a total of 7. And Halleck's army has retreated all the way back to New Albany, and it is demoralized. To rally that army, the Union has to spend 4 points of dice difference and 4 Western or discretionary command points, which would leave them with only 3 to conduct any other operations in the Western theater. And the rebels still have 3 Western command points and 4 discretionary command points. So that's 7 that could be used in the West. So Lee has pursued Halleck all the way to southern Indiana. However, this Union force under McDowell is substantial. There are 6 Union strength points, and the rebels have no forces in the area of Nashville. So that force under McDowell can do a lot of harm. The Union also has a chain of friendly hexes, which are connected here by rail, which leads to this hex from which McDowell launched the attack on the rebel fort. It's also important to note that McDowell could move over these hexes to continue to be supplied by rail and reach this hex here southwest of Bowling Green. If that happens, the Army of Tennessee can still trace supply by having supply traced along this route. So in one move, McDowell will not be able to cut off from supply the Army of Tennessee unless McDowell foregoes entering this hex and moves directly into Bowling Green, in which case McDowell will become out of supply himself. So the Union will spend 3 points of dice difference and its last 2 Western command points and 1 discretionary command point to activate McDowell's force. It will move 4 hexes, entering this hex, occupying the ironworks in Tennessee and reaching the hex southwest of Bowling Green. And by occupying or passing through the ironworks,
The Union gains another victory point. Now the Union spends its last point of dice difference to enter a reinforcement with the Army of the Cumberland, unless the reinforcement that is drawn is a promotion counter for a leader that is already in the map somewhere else. So let's make a random die roll. Roll is a one, so it is Winfield Scott Hancock, which is a very good leader. He is placed with the Army of the Cumberland, and he was sorely needed there. Now we move on to the next impulse, and the fate of Kentucky hangs on the balance. We roll for the Union, and it is an eight, which is not bad for them. Now we roll for the Confederates. Let's see who has the initiative. And this time it is the Union with a two-point difference. So the Union wins the initiative, dice difference of two. Now they enter a free reinforcement. Note that the dice difference is not enough to activate McDowell's army, which is marching north, about to enter Bowling Green and take the rebels from behind. So the Union will take the opportunity and spend 2 points of dice difference, as well as two naval command points, for the purpose of entering all their naval strength points. That means all the river ironclads, as well as the ocean and riverine transports. The ocean-going transports are placed in Philadelphia, and together with the one strength transport presently there, now the Union has 4 strength points of ocean-going transports. And the Yankees will place their riverine transports and ironclad in Cairo, Illinois, which is a gateway to the Mississippi River. From there, the Union can sail a flotilla down the Mississippi River and even attack Memphis, Tennessee, which is a very important city guarding the Mississippi, and it has a fortification there. So we have the Union flotilla there under the command of Foote. And they will most likely be sailing downstream pretty soon. Now the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference, as well as 2 eastern reinforcement points, for the purpose of increasing the strength of the Army of Northern Virginia. Now Beauregard's army has 8 strength points. Now we roll again for another impulse. The Union die roll is a 10, which is pretty good, actually. And now the Confederate die roll, it's a 7. So the Union has a 3-point dice difference, and they can enter a free reinforcement. And they will spend a point of Eastern Theater reinforcements to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac, which now has 8 strength points. Now the Union spends 2 points of dice difference for the purpose of removing the commander of the Army of the Potomac, the infamous Nathaniel Banks. So he is taken out of the game, and he's placed in the removed leader box, where he joins the distinguished Ben Butler. And now the new commander of the Army of the Potomac will be the ranking 3-star leader there, which is George McClellan. He's not a superstar, but compared to Banks, he actually looks like Napoleon. Finally, the Union uses its last point of dice difference to enter a leader with the Army of the Cumberland, and we will roll one die, and unless it's a leader coming up from promotion, that leader will go with Henry Halleck. The roll is a 3, and it is George Thomas, who had been wounded before, so now he returns to the Army of the Cumberland. Suddenly, the Army of the Cumberland, despite Halleck, has an impressive array of tactical subordinate leaders. So Lee is on the trail of Halleck's army, and at the same time, McDowell is creeping up from the south, so Lee has to make a decision as to whether he will try to knock out Halleck's army, which is tough to do across a navigable river, or he wants to deal with his problems to the south in Kentucky.
So the Confederates spend 1 point of dice difference for the purpose of entering a leader with Lee's Army of Tennessee. So we roll 1d6 to see which one it is. The roll is a 3 AP Hill, which is not too shabby. And AP Hill joins Sterling Price and an unnamed one-star leader with the Army of Tennessee. Now the rebels spend their last 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points for the purpose of activating A.P. Hill, who is presently with the Army of Tennessee. So of the 10 strength points with the Army of Tennessee, 3 are detached under the command now of A.P. Hill, and they will move 3 hexes here to Frankfort, Kentucky, taking control of that city, and with its last remaining movement point, A.P. Hill enters and occupies Lexington, Kentucky, increasing the rebel score by 2 points and reducing the Union score also by 2 points. And note now that A.P. Hill's force is out of supply because it cannot trace supply through this rail line, which is in the reaction radius of the Army of the Cumberland, and it cannot trace overland 4 hexes to a supply depot because there is none in the vicinity. So the effects of being out of supply is that if it's activated for movement, it will move one less, will have one less movement factor, will have only 3, and if attacked, irrespective of the result, it will be demoralized. Now we go to another impulse. Let's see what the Union die roll is. And it is a 4, which is not very impressive. Confederate die roll, 8. The Confederates win the initiative with a dice difference of 4. Now they enter a free reinforcement. Here we have the situation in Kentucky, which is very interesting. Lee's Army of Tennessee has beaten the Army of the Cumberland back across the Ohio River. However, Irving McDowell, with a total of 6 strength points, has been pushing from the west and is about to capture Bowling Green. Meanwhile, there's one Union strength point holding Mill Springs. That Union strength point is unsupplied. And Lee had to detach A.P. Hill and a total of 3 combat factors, which are currently occupying Lexington, and they also took Frankfort. Now, the rebels have to deal with these Union forces in their rear. McDowell could push south and start its move towards Tennessee, which is completely unguarded. And further to the west, we have significant naval forces gathering here in Cairo, Illinois, that could move down the Mississippi River in order to effect an attack here on Memphis, where there are currently 5 rebel strength points with 3 leaders under fortification. McClernand, who is a not one of the best leaders, he activates with 4 command points, has been stuck here in a swamp near the Mississippi River with 4 Union strength points. So on the one hand, Lee doesn't want to take the pressure off Halleck's army, but he has to guard against McDowell, which will definitely cut his supply if McDowell takes Bowling Green. So the Confederates will take their free reinforcement in the form of a reinforcement point from the discretionary track, which will appear here in Memphis, Tennessee. So now the rebels there have 6 strength points. And now the rebels will spend 3 points of dice difference, as well as their last Western Theater command point and 2 more discretionary command points for the purpose of activating Braxton Bragg, who is currently in Memphis, and 4 of the rebel strength points there.
That will leave two strength points in Memphis, Tennessee. And Bragg's force will be moved by rail, which will expend all four rail points for this turn for the Confederates. They will move through Corinth, through Decatur, and then turn north through Nashville to reach Bowling Green. And the Confederates spend their last point of dice difference to pick another leader to be placed with the Army of Tennessee. And we randomly selected this unnamed one-star leader, who now joins the staff of Lee's army. Now it's the Union's turn to spend 4 points of dice difference. And as shown here, in the West, the Union, the most they can spend is 2 command points, so they cannot activate any of their armies or forces there. The Union will spend 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points to activate this force with a 3-star general, which is currently in West Virginia, which moves into the mountain passes to attack the lone rebel strength point there. So we will resolve that combat right here. Let's see who that 3-star general is. And there's currently only one left in the Union 3-star general cup. And this is another one of those with a lot of red numbers. Oh, this is like the worst commander in the game, Fremont. So this is, at start, a 3-to-1 attack, but because the Yankees crossed a road hex side through the mountains, there's 2 column shifts to the left. So it's a +5 attack, which is still not bad for the Union. However, Fremont has a red 2 as a tactical rating. He gives a die roll modifier of 2 to the rebels. So we roll for the Union first. This is a combat between 2 small forces. The roll is a 4 and it is not modified. So that's a demoralization result against the defending Confederates. Now we roll 1d6 for the rebels. And the roll is a 2 modified to a 5, and the Yankees are also demoralized. So there's no losses in terms of strength points. The rebel force holds its ground in the mountains. And Fremont's force has to retreat, and there's no leader casualties. That's the end of the combat. Yankees have 1 more point of dice difference to spend, and they'll spend 1 Eastern reinforcement point to increase the strength of McClellan's Army of the Potomac, which now has a strength of 9. Now we go to another pulse. Let's see who has the initiative. The Union rolls a lowly 4, and the Confederates also a 4. So we have the same result. We consult the table use track. The action phase would be ended only by a 7. Both sides rolled a 4. So now we move the marker to the number 3 box and we add command points to each side. The Union result is a 3. So 4 command points are added to the east, 3 to the west, 2 to the Trans-Mississippi, 1 to the discretionary track, and 3 to the naval track. So these are the levels before the new additions and the levels after the additions. Note that the east command points for the Union, the level is 10. Confederates rolled a 7, so they add 6 command points to their primary theater of the west, 4 to the east, 1 to the Trans-Mississippi, and 2 to the discretionary track. Here's the command point levels before the additions. And here they are after the additions. Note that the eastern command points are at 11. So now we roll for a new pulse and for initiative once again. The Union die roll is a 7. And the Confederate die roll is a 6. The Union has a dice difference of 1 and they enter a free reinforcement. That will be a reinforcement point in the west, which will be placed in Cairo to increase their strength there, to to 2 strength points. Now they spend their other point of dice difference for the purpose of selecting a leader to be placed in Cairo, Illinois. We will select them randomly among those there, with 1 to 2 to Howard, 3 to 4 to Schofield, and 5 or 6 the cavalry leader. Roll is a 3, so Schofield is selected. And we place Schofield here in Cairo, Illinois, with the 2 Union strength points there. There's a considerable number of naval units in that city. Now the Confederates spend their point of dice difference and an Eastern reinforcement point to enter a reinforcement here in Staunton, Virginia, the Shenandoah Valley, increasing Confederate strength there to 2. On to another pulse. Union die roll is a 10. Interesting. Confederate die roll is an 8. Union wins the initiative and on to the free reinforcement. And they will take a reinforcement point from the west to continue to increase their force here in Cairo, where the Union now has 3 strength points. With a dice difference of 2 to spend, the Union doesn't have enough to activate any of their forces, so they'll spend the 2 points of dice difference and their 2 remaining Eastern reinforcement points to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac from 9 to 11 strength points. So the Confederates will spend their 2 points of dice difference for the purpose to bring 2 new leaders into the game. The first leader will be added to the Army of Northern Virginia. The roll is a 3, so it is Jubal Early, and Jubal Early is already with the Army of Northern Virginia. So his 2-star counter, which is his promotion counter, is placed, and we remove the 1-star version. Now we select another leader to be added to the Army of Northern Virginia, and that is Jeb Stuart. So the Army of Northern Virginia will have a cavalry leader. Onto another impulse, and unless there's a dice difference of 3 or more, there's not going to be any significant action. We roll for the Union, and the roll is a 3, which is very, very low. So let's see what the Confederates roll this time. Oops. We rolled a 4, and the other die roll is a 4, 8. So it's a 5-point difference. So the Confederates win the initiative, and we enter the free reinforcement. And it'll be the last reinforcement point in the east, which is assigned to the Army of Northern Virginia that now has 9 strength points. With a dice difference of 5, if the Confederates do nothing in the west, it is very likely that the demoralized Army of the Cumberland will be rallied, which will make it a tougher opponent for Lee to defeat. So the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points to activate Lee's Army of Tennessee, which is in Louisville. It wants to avoid attacking Halleck's demoralized army across a navigable river, so it will move to the hex southwest of New Albany. Halleck will attempt to react. He has to roll a 6 because his army is demoralized. The roll is a 5, and Halleck fails the reaction roll. So Lee crosses the Ohio River and now moves into New Albany, and Halleck will attempt to react once again. And Halleck also fails. So on we go now to the battle for New Albany, Indiana. So Lee's 7 strength point army attacks Halleck's demoralized army with 5. We would start at column F, but because the Yankee army is demoralized, there's a 1-column shift to the right to column G. Also, normally, Hancock and Thomas would give the Union a +4 die roll modifier, but because the army is demoralized, the Union die roll will be unmodified. In addition, Lee gives the Confederates 3 reroll options, but because the opposing army is demoralized, that would be doubled to 6, and Halleck would give 2 more because of that red 2 to Lee, but the maximum amount of reroll options in a combat is 6.
Now we have to determine who the two unnamed one-star rebel leaders are, and those are D.H. Hill and John Bell Hood, and they provide the rebel force with a +3 die roll modifier, but again, because the Yankee army is demoralized, that is doubled to +6, so very adverse conditions here for the Union army. We roll 1d6 for the rebels. And off the bat, they roll a 6, modified to a 12. That's the best result they can obtain against the Union. That's a demoralization and 3 strength points lost. So now the Union player rolls. The roll is an unmodified 3, which causes 1 strength point loss on the Confederate force. And if the Union rolls a 1 or a 2, it will be no loss at all. And the Confederates have a ton of reroll options to try to get that result. So they will spend their first reroll option to roll the Union die roll once again. The roll is a 5, a D1, so they will spend their second reroll option to roll again. And again, a 5 and a D1, so off goes the third reroll option. A 3, which causes 1 strength point of loss. They're not in agreement with that, so they spend their fourth reroll option. And finally, a 1. No strength point losses for the rebels. And leader losses were rolled, and Thomas is wounded, so he can still not be promoted to 3-star general. And his counter goes to the turn track for next turn, even though this is the last turn of this scenario. And note that if this were a campaign game, then Hood's 2-star and Hill's 2-star counter version would be placed in the turn record track, and they're eligible for promotion in the next turn. But this is a scenario that ends in this turn, so that will not happen. And the Union army is reduced to 3 strength points. And Lee's Army of Tennessee has captured New Albany, Indiana, adding another victory point for the rebels, and they have 6. And the Confederates will spend their last 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points, and they have 8 left, to activate this 3-star general who is currently in the rebel capital, Richmond, with 3 strength points, and he will move 4 hexes here to Staunton, Virginia, where the rebels already have a leader and 2 strength points, and also a depot, and now they have 5 strength points, 2 leaders, and a depot there. And the Union will start by spending 2 points of dice difference and 2 Eastern Theater command points, having 8 left. And the Union will build the Army of the James here in Fort Monroe on the Virginia Peninsula, where the Union already has 7 strength points and a 3-star general. So the Army of the James is created, and the rebels have moved the forces that they had in Richmond elsewhere. So the Yankees will take advantage of that, spending their last 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points to activate the newly created Army of the James. The Army of the James will move up the Virginia Peninsula into the hex with the Confederate fort. There are 2 Confederate strength points and a 1-star leader. And on we go now to the battle. So the Army of the James, 7 strength points, attacking 2 rebel strength points. We start in column K, 3-1, but there are some column shifts. The rebels are in swamp terrain. That's 1 shift to the left, and they are occupying fortifications. That's another shift to the left. So the attack will be solved in the H column, and we have to reveal who the 2 leaders are for both sides. We'll draw a leader from the 3-star leader cup for the Union, and now I realize that it is empty, so I obviously screwed up in that. So what we will do, I was checking around who has a 3-star rating for the Union, which could be conceivably available, And we have, in the union leader pool, actually, there is one leader left, a three-star leader, which is Howard. So I know this is not as per the rules, but Howard now will be the commander of that Army of the James. So Howard is the commander. Now we pick a leader from the one-star leader cup for the rebels to see who's going to be the leader of that force there in the fortification. And it is James Longstreet, which is pretty good himself. Union die roll is a 4, demoralization and a loss of 1 strength point on the rebel force. Now we roll for the rebels. And the roll is a 5, modified to an 8, also demoralization and 1 strength point loss. So it's the same result for both sides. The Union loses this battle and has to retreat back to its prior hex. And in the leader loss check, Longstreet rolled a 4, so Longstreet is dead. Both sides lose 1 strength point and are demoralized. So the Union attack on the rebel fortifications fails. The Army of the James retreats back to Fort Monroe. And we roll yet again for another impulse. The Union die roll is an 8. And the Confederate die roll, a 7. So the Union has won the initiative. They enter a free reinforcement. And as a free reinforcement, they will enter this cavalry leader with the Army of the Potomac. Place the leader together with the other subordinates. The Union uses its point of dice difference and one Eastern Theater command point for the purpose of getting some badly needed leadership to the struggling Army of the Cumberland. And Joe Hooker is detached from the Army of the Potomac. And he will use rail movement, and this rail movement does not consume any rail capacity points for the Union. And he will move in a westerly direction through Pennsylvania, through Ohio, and into Indiana, finally reaching the Army of the Cumberland north of New Albany for the purpose of having Hooker, who is a three-star general, available so that the Union now can sack and remove the hapless Henry Halleck from command in a future impulse. Now the Confederates spend 1 point of dice difference and an Eastern Theater command point for the purpose of moving the demoralized strength point in the mountain passes back to Staunton, Virginia, where it will join the rebel force there. And as a result of this movement, the whole rebel force in that hex will be demoralized. Now we roll again for initiative. The Union rolls a 4, which is pretty low, and the Confederates a 6. So this is a 2-point difference. The Confederates win the initiative, and they will enter a free reinforcement. They'll roll to see if it's Sterling Price or Joe Johnston. The roll is a 6. Johnston joins Lee's army, which is a formidable force, as you can see. Rebels spend 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points to activate Lee's Army of Tennessee once again. Lee intends to enter Halleck's hex to engage his demoralized army in combat. Halleck will roll to see if he can react, but he needs a 6. Roll is a 5, so Halleck does not react. And we have another battle, this time north of New Albany. Halleck has only 3 strength points left. Lee has 7. 7 rebel factors against 3 Union factors, 2-1. Lee has 6 reroll options and a die roll modifier of 6. And it's mainly because the Union Army is demoralized. The Union Army has no reroll options and no die roll modifier. So we roll first for the Confederates. 4 modified to a 10, demoralization, and 3 strength points lost by the Union. Now we roll for the Union. A 6, causing demoralization on the rebel army. And the rebels can start using their reroll options. If they reroll the Union die roll, and it is 1 through 4, the result will be no effect. So they burn 1 reroll option, and we will roll the Union die roll again. And that is the result, no effect. So the Union Army is eliminated. And as to leader losses, only John Bell Hood was wounded. So he would return in the next turn, although there will be no next turn. So the Union leaders are also placed in the turn track. And if there would be another next turn, they would enter as reinforcements then. But the Union army is eliminated. So as a result of the battle, Lee's Army of Tennessee destroys what was left of the Union Army of the Cumberland. And there is not much in the way of Union forces between Lee's army and Indianapolis. And the Union spends 2 points of dice difference and 2 Western Theater command points for the purpose of moving 2 of McClernand's 4 strength points over friendly hexes back to Cairo, Illinois, where the new strength points would join the 3 other strength points there. And now the Union has 5 strength points in that city. And what the Union has in mind is to later activate Foote, who would be able to move strength points with the naval flotilla down the Mississippi and attack the fortress or the fortifications at Memphis. But we go to another impulse. The Union rolls an 8, and the Confederates a 9. Rebels win the initiative. They enter a free reinforcement. Only one they can enter is Sterling Price, who is currently with the Army of Tennessee. So we place this 2-star version of Price with the Army of Tennessee, and he has been effectively promoted. And the rebels use their point of dice difference, 1 Eastern Theater command point. The purpose of moving this 1-star leader only, and he has up to 12 movement points, he will move to form part of the Army of Northern Virginia. And replace the counter with the other subordinate leaders. Now the Union spends its point of dice difference and 1 Western reinforcement point. Increase its force here in Cairo, Illinois to 6 strength points. Now to another impulse. The Union die roll is 5 and the Confederate die roll is 8. Confederates win the initiative. They don't have any reinforcements to enter in terms of new leaders or reinforcement points, so we go straight to the dice difference. And the rebels will use all 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points. Actually, this force, which has this demoralized strength point by entering the hex where the other strength points are, causes that the entire force be demoralized. So luckily I noticed that. So the 3 points of command theater, command points will be used to rally this entire force. So now the rebels have a force of 6 strength points in Staunton, Virginia, together with 2 leaders there. Now the Union spends its 3 points of dice difference and also 1 Western Theater and 2 discretionary command points to activate McDowell's force, and McDowell has 6 strength points. He will be moving into Bowling Green to attack Bragg. And remember that in this game we're using that optional rule that is in the unofficial 3rd edition rulebook of the game, where even forces that are not armies have a reaction radius composed of the hex in which they're in. Now, Bragg could attempt to react and move away, but if the Union forces capture Bowling Green, they will cut the supply of the Army of Tennessee, and it will become unsupplied in Union territory. So Bragg will fight this battle, and on we go with the Battle of Bowling Green. This is a pretty straightforward battle. The Union has 6, Confederates 4, so the differential is +2. Column F, there's no reasons to shift any column. And the rebels do not receive any tactical modification The Union gives, because of that red one in the right-hand side, it gives the Confederates a die roll modifier of one. So we roll 1d6 for the attacking Union troops. The roll is a one, no effect. Now we roll for the Confederates. Roll is a four modified to a five, demoralization and one strength point lost for the Union. So the attacking Union force loses the battle, a strength point, and is also demoralized. The Confederates have no strength point losses, and there are no leader losses. So McDowell fails to take Bowling Green, and also fails in cutting the line of supply for Lee's Army of Tennessee. Now to another pulse. The Union die roll is 5. Confederate die roll, 7. Confederates are winning a lot of these initiative die rolls. There's no reinforcements to enter for free, so they will spend their 2 points of dice difference and 2 discretionary command points to activate A.P. Hill's force in Lexington, Kentucky. A.P. Hill has 3 strength points there. And he moves his 3 strength points all the way south to Mill Springs, where he will engage in combat against that sole Union strength point. This is a 3-to-1 attack. There are no column shifts. And because of A.P. Hill's tactical rating, the rebels have a +1 die roll modifier. So we roll for the Confederates first. The result is a 3 modified to a 4. And the Union force suffers demoralization and 1 point of loss, which would destroy it. Now we roll for the Union. Roll is a 6. Still no effect. So the Union defenders are eliminated. And A.P. Hill has taken Mill Springs for the south. And the rebels gain another victory point, while the Union loses a victory point. It's important to note that because A.P. Hill was out of supply, the force is demoralized irrespective of the combat result, which in this case was a no effect. So A.P. Hill's force is demoralized. The Union spends its 2 points of dice difference and 2 naval command points for the purpose of activating Andrew Foote, who is a naval leader, and he has an initiative rating of 2. And by activating him, he can activate 6 naval strength points that can include ironclads and also transports that can carry troops. And the flotilla will sail down the Mississippi and here to make an amphibious attack against the city of Memphis, Tennessee, which has 2 rebel leaders, 2 strength points, and a fortification. So Foote will be able to activate or move 6 naval strength points. The Union has 4 ironclads, a riverine ironclad, so that counts each one as a naval strength point. So they will move only 2 riverine ironclads with the flotilla, and they have 4 transports, and each transport can carry 1 Union strength point. That means that the transports will carry 4 strength points, and they can carry the ground leader, which is Schofield, and there will be only 2 riverine ironclads with the flotilla. The other 2 will remain here in Cairo. So the flotilla with the strength points and the ground leader sails through these hex sides of the Mississippi River until reaching this one here, where it has to stop because it is controlled by the fortification of Memphis. And now we will solve an amphibious attack on Memphis. So let's go on with the battle. Okay, we're set to go to resolve this combat. Note that the Confederates have no naval units, no ironclads, so there's no round of naval combat to be resolved. We resolve the amphibious assault. And for that, we have to determine the strength of the attacking Union force and the defending Confederate force. The attacking Union force has a strength equal to that of their strength points, 4, plus half of the transports they have. They have four transports. That's two more for six, plus one for each ironclad, and that raises their strength to eight. Now we determine the strength of the Confederate force, and we start with one, which is the intrinsic value of the hex that is being attacked. One for each strength point. We have two, so we're at three. One if the hex contains a city. This is Memphis, yes, so we're at four. And one if it contains a fortification, and it does. So the total strength for the Confederates here is five. So this attack will be solved in the G column, plus three. And now we determine who is this Confederate leader that can add his tactical rating. It's a two-star leader. Notice that this is not an army, so we don't flip all the leaders, just the highest-ranking leader that will be in command of the force, and that is Bishop Leonidas Polk, and he has a white one. That means that he provides a plus one die roll modifier to the Union die roll. So the Confederates get no modification to their die roll. The Union die roll is modified with a plus one for Foote's tactical rating, plus one for Schofield, and plus one for Polk's tactical rating for a total of plus three. So we roll 1d6 for the Union first. The result is a 2 modified to a 5, and they cause demoralization and one strength point lost on the Confederate force. Now we roll for the Confederates, one die with no modification. The result is a 1, no strength point losses on the Union side. So the Confederate force is demoralized and suffers one strength point loss. The Union suffers no strength point loss, and there are no leader losses. The result of the amphibious assault on Memphis is that the rebels are demoralized, they lost one strength point and must retreat, and the Union force occupies Memphis, Tennessee. And that represents four victory points for the Union cause, which increases the Union score now to 30. Now we go to another impulse. The Union rolls an 11, and the Confederates, 7. Union wins the initiative with a dice difference of 4, and they enter a free reinforcement. And it will be one reinforcement strength point in the West. And they will increase their current strength in Cairo, Illinois, from 2 strength points to 3. As you can see, the Union cannot respond to what the Confederates are doing in the West. They have only one discretionary command point. They have a lot of command points in the East and the Trans-Mississippi. The Union spends 2 points of dice difference, 2 Trans-Mississippi command points, to build a depot here in Springfield, Missouri, that would allow Buell's force to continue marching south and still be supplied. They spend 1 point of dice difference, another Trans-Mississippi command point, to move this strength point, which is in St. Louis, Missouri, through rail movement, which would decrease the current rail capacity for the Union now to 3, reaching Cairo, Illinois, and now the Union will have 4 strength points there. And they spend their last point of dice difference and another Trans-Mississippi command point to move this strength point in Jefferson City, Missouri, also through rail movement, in this direction, passing through Cairo, Illinois, and using these hexes that are controlled by the Union to reach McDowell's force, which is southwest of Bowling Green. And that uses up another point of Union rail capacity. Now the Union force under McDowell has 6 strength points, and they are still demoralized. Now the Confederates spend 2 points of dice difference and their last 2 Western Theater command points for the purpose of moving A.P. Hill's force 3 hexes instead of 4 because it is unsupplied, and it will move to this hex here, from which it will now be supplied because it can trace supply through this rail hex leading to the south. And the rebels spend their last 2 points of dice difference and 2 discretionary command points to activate Lee's Army of Tennessee, and it will move
on to Cincinnati to battle it out with the strength points that the Union has there with a one-star general. The Union only has three strength points. The Army of Tennessee currently has seven. And the Union player will not attempt to react. And we'll have a battle for Cincinnati, which is worth three victory points. Confederates have seven strength points. The Union has three. No column shifts. So this is a 2-1 attack. We have to reveal who the Union one-star leader is. We pull one from the cup, and it is George Gordon Meade. So the Union will have a +1 die roll modifier. The Confederates have a +2 and three reroll options because of Lee's army combat rating. So we roll first for the attacking Confederates. The result is a 6 modified to an 8. The Union suffers demoralization and 2 points of strength lost. Now we roll for the Union. 5 modified to a 6, the Confederates would be demoralized. Now the Confederates can choose whether to exercise their reroll options. On a 1 through 4, they will obtain a better result, so the Confederates will burn their first reroll option and roll once again for the Union. Rolls a 4 modified to a 5, and I should have said on a modified die roll of 4 or better. Well, that's actually a modified die roll. Yes, a 4 or less, they get a better result. So the Rebels will burn another reroll option and roll again for the Union. A 6 modified to a 7, demoralization. So they will burn their last reroll option. Try to get a result that doesn't involve demoralization. Roll is a 5 modified to a 6. Still, the Rebels will be demoralized, and that's the end of the combat. And as to leader losses, Sterling Price was wounded, so he is out and placed in the next turn on the track, although this is the last turn of this scenario. Both forces are demoralized. The Union lost 2 strength points, and Lee's army wins the battle, and even though the army is demoralized, it manages to capture Cincinnati, Ohio. That's 3 more points to the Rebel score, and they have now 10. And on to another impulse. Union die roll, 7. And the Confederates roll 11. The Confederates win the initiative. They don't have any free reinforcements to enter. They only have command points in the east, 3 and 5 in the Trans-Mississippi, and only 1 strength point in the Trans-Mississippi. So there's not a lot they can do, actually. So they will use 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points, which now they have none. Activate the 3-star leader, which is currently here in Staunton, Virginia, where the Rebels have 6 strength points. They will leave 1 strength point there and also leave the 1-star leader with the depot there. And they will move the 3-star general with 5 Rebel strength points, 4 hexes to occupy Grafton, West Virginia. Now the Rebels take control of that city, and the Rebel force that just took the city is in supply because it can trace a supply line 4 hexes, which is the maximum that it can be traced to a friendly depot. Now the Confederate victory point score jumps now to 11. Confederates spend their last point of dice difference and 1 Trans-Mississippi command point, although the Confederates won't move their sole strength point in the Trans-Mississippi, so that command point is wasted. Union spends 1 point of dice difference, its last discretionary reinforcement point, to increase the strength of the Army of the Potomac to 12 strength points, and spends the last 3 points of dice difference and 3 Eastern Theater command points to activate the Army of the Potomac, and it moves 1 hex in a southwest direction, and the next hex it will move in will be across the Rappahannock River and into a wooded area. That hex is in the reaction radius of Beauregard's Army of Northern Virginia, and Beauregard will attempt to react into that hex. He needs to roll 4 or higher. And the roll is a 5, so Beauregard reacts successfully into the hex where the Army of the Potomac moves, and we have a battle.
and onto the battles. So here we have the forces, or the armies, in battle. The Army of the Potomac attacking the Army of Northern Virginia, 12 versus 9 strength points. We start with the G column, but there are column shifts. The Union Army crossed in a navigable river. That's one shift to the left, and the defending rebels are in forest terrain. So that is two shifts to the left. So the combat will be resolved in the E column. And we also have to determine who the unnamed one-star general for the Confederates is. So we draw one from our one-star cup. And it is William Joseph Hardee. He adds one to the Confederate die roll. So the Confederates will receive a +4 die roll modifier. Now we have to reveal who the cavalry general for the Union is. So we draw one from the cup. And it is James Harrison Wilson. He adds one to the Union die roll. So we're all set. The Union Army is a large force. The Confederates a medium force. So we roll first for the attackers. The roll is a 4 modified to a 5. Demoralization and 1 point of strength lost on the Confederate side. Now we roll for the Confederates. 1 + 4, 5. Also demoralization and 1 strength point lost for the Union. So this result guarantees a Union retreat because it's the same result on both sides and the Union is attacking. The Confederates, if they reroll any of the dice on any side, they risk the chance of having the Union obtain a better result, so they will not use their reroll options, and that is the end of the battle. And as to leader losses, Wilson, the cavalry leader that just had his first battle, is wounded, so he's removed and placed in the turn record track for next turn, although this is the last turn of the scenario. No other leader losses. And Union and the Confederates each lose a strength point and are demoralized. So the Union retreats its army, and both armies are demoralized. And on we go to another impulse. The Union die roll is 9, and the Confederates an 8. No reinforcements to enter for free. The Union spends its point of dice difference and one naval command point, but it will not make any actions with its naval forces, so that command point is wasted. Now the Confederates spend 1 point of dice difference and one Trans-Mississippi command point. Confederates could, with the command point, move this strength point. They will not do so at this time, but they will destroy this depot. And that doesn't cost any command points, but it is destroyed to prevent the Union from using it. On we go to another impulse. Union die roll, a 2. Confederate die roll, 7. Confederates have a 5-point difference. And they have no reinforcements to enter. And they will be forced to use all 3 Trans-Mississippi command points. The dice difference is reduced to 2. And Trans-Mississippi command points are reduced to 0. So with 3 command points, the rebels will build a fortification, which costs just that, 3 command points, and it has to be built in a hex, which is in supply and has 1 strength point, so it will be built here in Clarksville, Arkansas. Rebels have no more command points to spend, so the 2 points of dice difference is wasted. The Union has 5 points of dice difference to spend. The Union has somewhat of a naval force here, some transports in Philadelphia with a 1-star leader, and 1 strength point. They will use 2 points of dice difference and 2 naval command points, and the Union will activate Andrew Foote, who is here in Philadelphia, together with there's a total of 4 transports, 1 strength point, and a 1-star Union leader. And he can activate the whole force. It will move from Philadelphia out to the sea in this direction here, continuing here to attack Fort Fisher, an unoccupied rebel fortress. Now we resolve this amphibious attack. So we conduct this amphibious invasion. Let's see first who is the unnamed Union one-star general. And it is Franz Siegel. He is pretty atrocious. He gives up +2 to the rebels. So we calculate the strength of the Union force, 1 for the strength point, and it's half of the strength of the transport. So that's, we have 4, so that's 2, so we're at 3. And that is the total strength of the Union force with a +1 tactical die roll modifier because only of Porter. Siegel gives a +2 to the Confederate fortress. And we calculate now the strength of the Confederates for this attack. The hex has an intrinsic value of 1. There are no strength points. There's no city there. And there's no fort, but there's a fortress which gives 2 more strength points. So the Confederates have a total strength of 3. So this attack is resolved on the E column. And we roll for the attackers first. 1d6 for the Union. A 2 modified to a 3, and that is no effect. Now we roll for the Confederates. 5 modified to a 7, d1. So the Union force is demoralized and loses its sole strength point. So the attack is a failure, and the Union force returns to its port of origin. Note that we do not place demoralization markers on naval forces, only on land forces, but the sole strength point, ground combat strength point, was eliminated. So the Union now spends its last 3 points of dice difference, and its last 2 Trans-Mississippi command points, as well as its last discretionary command point. Activate Buell's force. It will move 4 hexes here into Fayetteville, Arkansas, capturing that city, and that adds 1 victory point to the Union total, which is now 31. Seems that the action phase is about to end. Only the Union has any command points, and it's 1 in the east and 1 naval. But we still have to roll. So this is a new impulse. The Union rolls a 10, and the Confederates an 8. Union wins the initiative with an initiative or dice difference of 2, and we'll spend both points of dice difference. And 1 Eastern Theater command point, as well as the naval command point. The naval command point will be wasted, because no action can be conducted with just 1 naval command point. And actually, when we look at possibilities with 1 command point in the east, there's not a lot that the Union can do. They don't want to take any out of Washington, cannot attack, cannot rally any forces, so that command point is wasted also. This is the end of the action round. We have to move the command point table total marker. Number of boxes equal to the amount of times that we use the command point table, which is 3. So it is moved to the number 8 box. And now to the rally phase, we remove demoralization markers from those of forces and armies that have any, and we have to eliminate 1 strength point from the force or army. And as a result of the elimination of strength points, because forces were demoralized, the Union force that was here was destroyed, eliminated, and the leader's placed in the turn record track for the next turn. This is the Union force that was next to Lee's Army of Tennessee in Ohio. And also the rebel force that was in Memphis was also eliminated. So we add the command point table use total, which is 8, to the number of Confederate victory points to obtain the total score of rebel victory points. So it will be 19. And now we check the rule book to see who wins. The Union has 31 strength points, and the difference is 12. So this is a Confederate marginal victory, and that is the end of this 1861 scenario. This is the end of this video, and this is the longest playthrough video I've ever made, but for me, It was a pleasure because this is simply a brilliant game. It is as fresh as when it came out in 1983. The action round impulse dice differential mechanic is simply brilliant. It ensures high replayability and it injects a lot of uncertainty. You don't know if you will be able to move all the forces you want to move, and sometimes the enemy may spring a trap, and it just keeps that excitement level and the back and forth and the action reaction type of gameplay, which makes this game so fun to play. I know that GMT is coming out with a new strategic Civil War game these days, designed by Mark Simonich, which borrows some of the successful mechanics from this game, and I'm looking forward also to that game when it comes out. So this is Stuka Joe signing off for now. Thanks for watching.